Good afternoon, traders, and welcome back to the CFRN Emini Futures Cast. This is the daily broadcast of indeterminate length where we discuss all things Emini along with some really big ideas on the finer points of trading gold, bonds, crude, sugar, the euro, and even T-bills. Joining us today from our studios in Boston, Mr. Michael Bork. From our trading desk in Chicago, Mr. Burton Schlichter. And from our studios in Las Vegas, Nevada, Mr. David Williams. Now, to get things started, let's go to our host and founder in Studio A, overlooking South Mountain, America's largest city park. Here's Dwayne.
Good afternoon. Welcome back. Today is Wednesday, 22nd day of January, 2014. Quick look at the numbers. The Dow is down 57 points. The S&P is down just over a point. NASDAQ is up 11. Gold is down $2. Crude is up $1.70 a barrel. Those are the numbers. Happy Wednesday. Hump day already? Wow. That's what a holiday will do. Just that week over fast. Seriously, Wednesday. And for the month, we're already over the month hump thing, right? Today's the 22nd. We got a little over a week left in the first month of the new year, 2014. So glad you've joined us today. Perhaps you found us out. You were Googling for the Holy Grail. You were looking for some way that you could just trade in your boxers and not ever get stomped out and make a lot of money. People would admire you and respect you and ask for your auto. And you found us, right? I mean, typically that's where that type of a Google search will bring you, is right here. Our humble little radio show that we are now in our eighth year producing, heading, creeping up on year number nine. So we hope that if today is your first day, number one, that you'll enjoy your visit, and that number two, you will make this radio program a part of your daily routine. When people say, hey, what do you do every day at noon Eastern? I listen to CFRN. What do you think? Oh, okay. See how easy that is? Just pencil it in. Don't bother me between 12 and 2 Eastern, because I got radio to listen to. All right. Now, if you can't see the chart I have up, it is the S&P 500 E-mini futures, and it is the hourly chart. Okay? If you can't see it, it could be you're not fully engaged. You may have clicked a link somewhere that allows you to just hear the audio stream. Tell you what, go to CFRN.net. That's our homepage. On the right-hand side, click that big microphone. It's got those three handsome guys right next to it. I won't tell you which one I am. See if you can guess. Click that. Follow the instructions. You'll be registered all the way through the end of the month. Yeah, that's like 9 more days, but anyway. In other words, you're going to get an email each day that says, radio show starts at noon. When you're ready to join the show, click here. And then you just click and you're in with one-click access. Now, when I say join the show, I literally mean join the show. We like it when you participate in the discussion. Okay? We're going to talk about who knows what today. Of course, we'll talk about the markets. David might go off on some kind of healthcare rant. I might, there's no telling what I might end up talking about, but whatever we talk about, along with the markets, we'd like to get your input. Okay, so there's a little chat box. Use that thing. Put it to good use. You got a question? Ask it. Pithy comment? Make it. There's a market you want to look at that we don't normally look at? Ask. As long as there's time, we'll bring it up. We'll put it on the screen. We'll talk about it. We'll dissect it. We'll see if we see any opportunity in that market, if we see a trade on the horizon. Okay, so you're running the show by your questions. Now, if you have something to share that would take too long to type, or you simply love the sound of your own voice, did you know that you can become a part of this radio show today by calling toll-free 866-928-3310? 866-928-3310. Don't call just yet, because we got a few things, got a little housekeeping to do, a couple things to take care of. But once David comes on from Page Trader, I think Robin's going to be with us today, the trading coach. Once they come on, if you'd like to chat, join the join the discussion. Call us toll-free, 866-928-3310. Leslie will probably answer the phone. Just say, could you connect me to the radio show, please? They'll plug you right in. They'll patch you in, all right? And we'll have a chat. Love for you to do that. Let's go to our good word for the day, and then we'll talk about this chart that I have up on the screen right now. Looks like somebody's already typing in the chat box. Let me see what they got here. Okay. All right. To get or to give, which is better? Which is more important? What are you thinking about? Luke 19 says this, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." That's Luke 19:10. During Jesus' ministry, the crowds around him were even greater than football fans around Peyton Manning. And, well, that's a lot of people, right? Jesus was coming to his town, and there was a short man, a little guy named Zacchaeus, who was determined to see him. So determined that he climbed up in a tree to get a better look. Now, it's not every day that the richest and also the most despised man in town climbs a tree to do anything, much less to see some itinerant preacher like this Jesus. Of course, Jesus saw him and knew he was searching, looking for meaning, something that money and power won't get you. So Jesus walked over to the tree. He looked up and asked Zach if he could come to his house for lunch. The guy probably almost fell out of the tree, right? Maybe he did fall out of the tree. I don't know. I wasn't there. The crowd, on the other hand, they didn't find this cute at all. They were appalled. Because, you see, Zacchaeus was not only a well-known man, he was a well-hated man. The people considered him to be evil and rich from the money that they worked hard to earn. Yet Jesus had other plans, and meeting Jesus changed Zacchaeus' life forever. He not only recognized that Jesus was the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, but he knew he needed to make restitution and pay back all the people he had defrauded. He even gave money to the poor. What a change. He went from a desire to get to a desire to give. Jesus told the crowd that he had come to seek and save those who were spiritually lost. Zacchaeus was definitely spiritually lost. That's mighty good news for those of you who feel far from God right now. Right at this moment in time, you feel distant. Money, power, it's left you feeling a little bit empty, like Zacchaeus. I want you to be encouraged. You don't even have to climb a tree because someone else climbed a tree for you. And no, I'm not talking about Zacchaeus. I'm talking about Jesus. Mm-hmm. He came for people like Zacchaeus. He came for people like me. He came for people like you. I encourage you today, invite him in, and you too will discover the true meaning of life. And that's our good word for the day. Let's go to the chart. S&P 500 E-mini futures. Let's see, you've got a chart in the chat box. I got a question in the chat box. Let me look. Do you think perhaps your zone 1841.42 is off? It looks like it should be 3839. How do you psych yourself out of doubt with your indicators and not think it's such a biggie? Iris, I'm not sure I follow your question. Try asking that again, okay? It could be one little word that got off or a misspelling, and so I'm not connecting with the question. I'd love to answer it for you. Let me double check and make sure I'm displaying the proper zone, 1841/42. Maybe I did get it off. 1841, 1842. No, that's the zone. So let me ask again. Your question says, do you think perhaps your zone 4142 is off? It should be 3839. No. But please share with me why you think that. And then the other part of your question about the indicators and not think it's such a biggie. I'm not sure. I'm not following you there, okay? In fact, that doesn't sound like your normal line of questioning, but that's okay. I do want to answer it, so please rephrase it so that I can answer it for you. And while we're talking about this chart, let's talk about this chart. We had a tweet earlier in the week that said, consider being long above 1837. Price ran up to the zone at 41.42. So from 37 to 41, that's a 4-point move. Price came back and tested 1837 to the tick and then ran right back up to the zone at 41.42. And so even though we're only looking for 8 ticks a day on the S&P, or the equivalent in any other market. Anytime you hear me say 2 points, I'm talking about the S&P, but what I'm really saying is $100 per contract per day. So if you're trading the Russell, it's 10 ticks. Gold or crude, it's 10 ticks. The Euro, the S&P, 8 ticks. Okay. Bottom line is when you do the math, it equals $100 per contract per day. So we had the tweet that ran 4 points from 87 to 41. Now you'll notice that when Michael trades in the live trading room, okay, he doesn't use a target. He trails his stop. This allows him to take more than just 2 points out of a trade if the market offers it, okay? But for those of you who have made a commitment to the 2-year plan and your goal is that in 2 years you graduate as a 20 contract trader, for those of you who have committed to that path, to that way of learning to trade, you're going to get your 8 ticks and you're done, all right? But we had a 4-point move back to test the important. Now, we've got this thing. We really believe that important prices and important areas are almost always tested, okay? Was this Yes. Went right back up, came right back down. Okay. So two opportunities here off of that tweet. Now, price then dropped to a weekly trading zone below at 1827/28. Okay. Yesterday, I had put this zone on the chart, and I put this zone on the chart. I didn't put the zone in the middle. Because it was just Tuesday, first day of the week, you know, I mean, the zones are for the partners, and maybe if you're new, you don't even understand what that means. Partners are those who have become a part of our community. They've made a commitment. They want to be part of the family. They've gone through a 90-day period of learning how to trade, and every Monday morning, before the market opens, I send out an email to each and every partner that has not only the link to the live trading room and the password and the link to the workshop, but also the weekly trading zones for some select markets. I do the S&P, the yen, bonds, the Dow, the Euro, and the Russell. Okay. Once we publish the zones, in other words, once I email them to partners before the market opens on Monday, once they're out, that's it. They're carved in stone. We don't change them, modify them, any of that. They just simply are. And then we sit back and we watch what happens, and we watch how price interacts with the zones. As price gets close to a zone, it begins to act like a magnet, and it just kind of pulls it right in. Once price hits a zone, as it did here, we expect price to consolidate for a period of time. Sometimes you'll hear people use the term, the market is coiling. Okay, what does that mean? All right, see, got a couple of big hourly candles here. Then you've got these small 1, 2, 3, 4 hours. 4 hours, the market stayed inside of that 1 point area. 41 to 42. That's coiling. That's consolidating. Here's what's happening. The market is making up its mind if it's going to continue the advance to the zone overhead or if it's going to retreat to the zone below. Okay? So what happened here, consolidated for 4 hours, we began the move down. But we had this important area at 37. That stopped price in its tracks, sent it back up to the zone. Now the market's in that same position again. It's got to decide, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Well, we can see what it did. Dropped right down to the zone at 27.28. But we had a zone in the middle there, and I'll put that on the screen today. I told you yesterday that I would put it up there today. Partners had this zone before the market opened. This week they got the zones late because of the holiday. But we've been publishing the zones now for, I think it's almost 4 years. You can go out on the blog, take a look at the charts. So that zone is 35, 36. 35, 36. Okay. So look what happened here. When price came down, see, it couldn't quite get to that zone. Because we knew 37 was kind of a big deal. Takes it back up, comes back, it hits the zone, and it bounces. Okay? So we spend a period of time here consolidating. Remember, these are hourly candles. Then we make the drop from zone to zone. Price doesn't spend a lot of time down in this area. Okay? I mean, buyers are eager to run this thing back up, hence the wick. Then we come right back down, and buyers push it right back up again. Okay? So we've got good buying support here. We push it back up to the zone. Then what happens? We go sideways for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, basically 10 hours. And then we get our move back to the zone at 41.42. Okay. And then we had a tweet that said, consider being short below 39, which the 8 tick target's 37. Okay. We never risk more than 8 ticks on a trade. Doesn't matter if it's even a volatile market like gold or crude. 8 ticks, that's all. If someone in the live trading room this morning, they were visiting for the first time, they were blown away that we trade natural gas with an 8-tick stop, but we do. Our proprietary indicator set, which as a partner, you own that indicator set for life, okay? It's designed, it embraces the underlying rhythm of the market. That's how we're able to take trades in volatile markets like natural gas and only risk 8 ticks, okay? So we come from 39 to 37. We actually touched the zone this time at 35, 36. Then right back up to the 41, 42, and then back down from 39 to 37. Well, actually, if we were looking at a smaller time frame, and if we go to a smaller time frame later in the show, I'll point this out. But see, here we have a move from 39 to 37. This hourly candle here goes from 39 to 37. This hourly candle goes from 39 to 37. So I had put times 2 here. Actually, not that it matters, there was a times 3. Now, one thing you may notice is, wait a minute, there was a tweet and it happened twice. Wait, there was a tweet and it happened thrice. Does it always do that? No, not always. There are very few absolutes in the world of trading. But when we do have a tweet that does go off and it goes off, you know, exceedingly well, without a hitch, there is a high probability that price will come back, test that area, and do it again. So a good tweet quite often will make itself available 2 times. 3 times is not unusual. Even 4 is not that unusual. The last time I remember it going 5 times was on crude, and that's been a number of months ago. But again, for those who've committed to the 2-year plan and your goal is to graduate in 2 years as a 20 contract trader, you're only worried about the first move anyway. Okay? As long as it's in the same trading session, you're going to take one trade. That's going to give you your 2 points, 8 ticks, your $100 per contract per day, and then you're done. And all the trades you don't use today, they roll right over to tomorrow. Okay? And so here we sit at 1839. Remember, that was the important price, important area that triggered us into the trade. Okay? Is it possible that we're going to get we've already got 3. Is it possible we'll get a 4th move from 39 to 37? Yeah, it's possible. Because here's what's going to happen. Price is up in this area now. We've come within, the high is 40 and a half. So we've come within 2 ticks of touching the zone. Price will either consolidate here a bit and then move to the zone overhead, or we'll go to the zone below. That's just how it works. You see it here. Price goes from zone to the zone to the zone to the zone, back to the zone, up to the zone, down to the zone, up to the zone, down to the zone. This is not some anomaly that just happened this week, and so I'm sharing it with you. This is a day in and day out kind of thing. Now, just because partners have these numbers before the market opens, before the week starts, it doesn't make their job easy. But it does help to make it a little more simple because it establishes some boundaries. Think of it perhaps since we're coming up on, I think they call it the World Series. And on the World Series, they're going to have this
Super Bowl.
Super Bowl. And they're going to have all this nice freshly mown grass. Yeah, you mow it. So if once you mow the grass, do you say it has been mown? M-O-W-N, is that a word?
Mown?
Yeah, freshly mown grass. I think that really is a word. M-O-W-N, mown. Yeah, you can say that. So anyway, think of it as the gridiron. Come on, guys, I know what a football field is, kind of. No, really, I do. And it's got all these little white lines on it. You know, the 10, the 20, the 30, the 40, the 50-yard line. You can think, when you put your zones on the chart for the week, you can kind of think of it like that. And the very top would be an end zone, and the bottom would be an end zone. And we don't expect the players to run off the field during the week. We expect them to stay on the field inside of those zones. Every now and then, we have one run off, but typically when it does, by close of business on Friday, it will get itself back onto the playing field. I think, Michael, was it a couple months ago we had a week that closed outside of the zone on the S&P?
I think so.
I think there might have been once in the past year, but that in itself is not going to make any money. That's just sort of a fun fact to know and tell. Okay, that price will almost always close inside of the weekly trading zones on any given. So I've talked this S&P chart to death, and Michael needs to come in and do the recap because we had a nice day in the live trading room, didn't we, Michael?
We did.
Yes, we did. So I'm going to let him tell you all about that. We had some other tweets. We had some, you know, the bonds made a move. Stuff happened. And we'll talk more about that as we go through the show today. We'll look at the different markets. Michael is going to take the charts right now, and he's going to recap everything that happened today in the live trading room. The good, the bad, the mediocre. Okay, we don't sweep anything under the carpet because you just end up tripping over that, and it causes you troubles. So now, if you've watched Haven, you know about troubles, but I digress. We'll stay away from that. Now, as he walks you through this, I want you to think about how you would handle these trades, how you would handle being stopped out, how you would handle being able to just get right back into the game and take the next trade. See, if your current style or methodology does not allow for that, then gather around and pay close attention to what Michael's going to share with you during the next 10, 15, 20 minutes. It literally has the power to change your trading forever because he's going to show you real life examples of thinking in probabilities. Michael, it's all yours.
All right. And Robin, I am hunkered down in the snow.
Oh, Robin is with us today. Very good.
She is. Yep. All right. Let me turn the recording on. And, Bart, all the markets that we trade, you could trade with 20 contracts. You might not get a complete fill on everyone, but you can certainly put the order on there. And, I mean, if you just look at it, you know, like this is crude oil. Look over here in the ask and over here in the bid. Almost all of them have more than 20. So, and you can trade 20 contracts on any of these. I just wanted to answer your question, too. All right, let me start recording here. All right, good afternoon, everyone. Today is Wednesday, the 22nd day of January 2014. Let me go over the results first. We were minus 8 on soybeans, plus 4 on natural gas, plus 13 on crude oil, and plus 2 on gold. This morning, it took us an hour and 4 trades to get to $100 a contract. We took a total of 11 trades this morning. And so far, on the month of January, we are up $3,530 a contract, gross. $3,530 gross. If you apply an $8 commission to every trade we've taken 158 trades, your net would be $22.66. If you apply a $5 commission, your net would be $27.40. Okay. That's where we stand on the month. All right. Now, let me slide that off. Again, $3,530. I think it's 14 trading days. Is that what we have so far? 303 to 316. Yeah, I think so. 14 trading days, I'm pretty sure. Now, if you have not taken a free trial with us, go to www.cfrn.net/apply, sign up for your free trial. In the free trial, you will get access to everything that you see here. Okay, every single thing you see here, you will get access to. And you'll have 5 days in our live trading room. Right? Our live trading room runs from 9:30 in the morning to 11:30 in the morning Eastern Standard Time. All right. Now, let's go through the trades. I'll start out with, what do I have over here? Let me put that back. And what is this? Natural gas. I'll put that over there. I'll start out with crude oil. Okay. On crude today, we ended plus 13 ticks today on crude oil. Alright. Let's see here. Our first trade of the morning was right here on the crude, and we took 8 ticks profit on that. It was an up close above the trend line with the bullish divergence. We took 8 ticks profit on that first trade. Then crude got sideways for a little while here, for about a half an hour. It went sideways, started to consolidate. It broke up above this box, which is what I was looking for long trades. To take more long trades, I was looking for to get up above there. We did get into another trade over here. It went 5 or 6 ticks in profit, came back, and took me out of break even. Okay, the next trade we took was over here. It was a short trade. We shorted a close down below the trend line, though I didn't draw the trend line on there, but it would have closed down below the trend line had I drawn it. And we ended up taking a break even on that as well. The next one was over here, a close above the trend line. We went long on that, and it gave us 4 ticks profit, and it came back and took us out of break even. And finally, the last one, I think I took 5 ticks profit on that move right there. Okay, that was where I ended trading for the morning. That was crude oil. We took 5 trades on crude. That's what I have, 5 trades on crude this morning. All right, we ended plus 13 ticks. Now, our very first trade of the day, though, was on natural gas, so I'll do that right now. We took a few natural gas trades today, and we ended up positive on natural gas by 4 ticks, but our very first trade, I actually think I took it pre-market. Yeah, 9:29. It was right here. It was an up close with bullish divergence off the BBC. I got long right there, and it stopped me out right away, so I was in the hole for my very first trade. It moved around a lot, but it wasn't moving around with any real, I don't want to say direction, but it wasn't putting in higher swings and everything that I need to take trades. So I waited, and I waited, and I waited. There was a short right over here that I missed, but I finally got in over here on a long trade off the BBC. Okay, I got in right in here, and I think on that first one, I took 6 ticks profit. And on the second one, I took another 6 ticks profit. I think that's how it worked out. I took 6 ticks profit on this one, and then 6 ticks profit again on this one. Now, you might be asking yourself, why didn't I just hold on to it and ride it all the way up? Well, because the green line got up into the cycle, and when the green line gets up into the cycle, I trail my stop right behind price. Because when the divergence has gone away, it's time for it to pull back again, and I don't like to give back profit that I have. So I'd rather take 2 trades and give back, all the profit. Alright, that's why I did that. That was natural gas. That's all we did on natural gas. Now let's see, since the close of the morning session, there's nothing in here. It changed directions right in here. Could have gotten long right in there. Would have been a break even for me. Could have gotten long right there. Would have been a break even for me. And could have gotten short over here, and it would have been a break even for me. So 3 break even trades here, because it doesn't seem to be following through all that well. All right, that was it on the natural gas. Now, we didn't trade copper. We didn't even look at the ES this morning because it was just choppy. Soybeans, we did take soybeans. We took 1 trade in soybeans. I was right here. Down close below this trend line. I should have moved my stop to break even on that, but I didn't. I didn't move it fast enough, and ended up taking me out at -8 ticks. So I've lost 8 ticks on soybeans this morning. The soybeans did some nice movement. They did have some nice movement in the pre-market. You see this move right here from 84 right down to 76. That worked out pretty well. I believe we also said this morning a close down below 78 should get you 76. It went within a tick of 76 right there. And on this one, it closed down below and it went right through 76. All right. Now, from 76, did I say a close below 74 should get you 72? I don't think so. That's not right. That's not right. That 74 is for the way up, not the way down. A close below 70 should get you 68, probably, right now, for the partners. Okay. All right. I feel like I'm rambling. I haven't covered the Russell yet. I didn't take a single trade on the Russell this morning. Okay. The way the indexes started out this morning, I mean, if you look at it right here, they started out right here and they just went sideways all morning until the close of the morning session. And then they moved up. All right. So I didn't want to trade any of these. The ES was in his zone, or the Russell was in his zone, or too close to his zone, or something like that all morning. I didn't take a single trade on the Russell this morning. All right, I'm going to put that back, and now we'll do gold, because we did trade gold. Now, let's see. On gold, I believe we had 2 trades on gold. Yeah, we did. We had this one right here, which was a down close below the trend line. Let me put the trend line on there for you. Okay, there's the trend line. That was the down close below the trend line. That was a shorting opportunity, 39.3. I took 10 ticks profit on that. And then I went to do it again on the down close below the trend line again, and it took 8 ticks of that back. So I ended up +2 on gold. Those were all the trades that I had on gold. This is kind of odd on gold that you can see the whole market from here to here in one screen at this size. It's, you know, usually gold has a lot more activity than this, but really there were no news events today at all in the U.S. There were a bunch of global news events, but for the U.S. markets, it was nothing, which made it kind of... I was afraid it was going to make it really, really slow. Now, we managed to get 11 trades out of the day, so it wasn't that bad, but that was it. All right, so that's it. Those are all the markets that we traded today, and let's just bring my spreadsheet back up here. If you have not taken a free trial with us, go to CFRN.net. Let me show you where that is. Here it comes. If you have not taken a free trial with us, go to CFRN.net and sign in right in here. Where it says name, just put in your name. Where it says email, put in your email. Once you do that, you'll be sent a link, a confirmation link. You need to click on that confirmation link. And then we'll know that you signed up, and we'll send you all the information you need to download the charting platform, to get into the live trading room, to do all those things that you so want to do. And that's it. That's all I got. On the month, we're up 35.30. We've traded 158 times so far in the month of January. All right. And that's it, Dwayne. We're ready to go out to Vegas.
No way. You barely got started.
Sorry. I know it was fast. That was a quick one.
So we get our 2 points?
We did. We did get our 2 points.
Okay.
We got them, very good. Got them pretty early, too. Actually, no, it took us an hour today.
That took an hour today.
Yeah, that's now, a long time compared to yesterday.
We were just funning around, and last week we allotted you 10 trades a day. The same as we would allot someone on the two-year program, 10 trades a day. And you ended up the week with 35 trades left over, was it?
I think I had 34. I think
34. Okay. And so then coming into this week, yesterday, Tuesday, you get issued 10 fresh trades. So that brought you up to 45 or something?
40, I think I had 35 coming in. That's what it was. I had 35 coming in, and then yesterday I had 10 more that made it 45. Then I used one to get the goal.
Okay.
And so that put me at 44 yesterday. So I had 10 more coming in today. So I had 54, and I used four of them. So I have 50.
Okay.
That's right.
So tomorrow, when he comes in, we're going to give him 10 fresh trades. So tomorrow, Michael will have 60 trades at his disposal, 60 trades to take $100 out of the market per contract. That would be 10 ticks on gold, 8 ticks on the S&P. And I know that sounds a bit ridiculous, but here's the point. When I say he has that many trades available, if it took him all of those trades, okay, if he had to use up every one of those things to hit his daily goal, he would still be on track to graduate at the end of 2 years as a 20-contract trader. If you want more information on how the two-year program works, send me an email, support@cfrn.net. I can go over it with you by phone, by email. We can launch a go-to meeting, whatever works best for you. And we can even reach across the big pond and do it, because I did just that very thing yesterday with one of our partners who is in the UK somewhere. And we had a nice brief conversation on the go-to meeting, and he was able to grasp it just like that. And so, and he had a nice day today. It took him two trades. So coming in tomorrow, he's now committed to the two-year plan. So tomorrow, he will have 18 trades at his disposal to get his 8 ticks or 10 ticks, depending upon the market that he's trading in. So that's awesome.
He's actually in this, France.
Huh?
I said he's actually in France. He's a British.
Is that
guy
not
in
considered the UK?
No.
Hmm. You would know because you're French.
Because I'm French. And because I lived in the UK.
The first Frenchman I ever knew was a little short guy on Hogan's Heroes. I think they called him Frenchie. I think that was his name.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, now there were questions in the chat box, and that question earlier, which had come from Iris, and she did thank you, Iris, for coming back and trying to clear that up a little bit. She says, I have a situation when I start doubting myself, which keeps me from trading when this happens. Where are the important prices and support areas to convince myself? You know, based on the way you worded that, rather than just spew something out, and I see where you went on to go, hey, you answered my question with your explanation. Thank you for your help. I'm so glad I could help. But there's something about the way you worded the last part of that question. Where are the important prices and support areas to convince myself? I'm going to dwell on that a little bit, because I think there might even be that question might have more layers than even you're aware of, and you ask the question. Convince myself. That's good. I'm going to think about that. Michael, you've covered the recap. We got the points. We did the deal. I'm trying to think if there is anything else I want to cover. I keep wanting to do this every day, and then I say I'm going to hold off another day. All right, there'll be an official press release and all of that. And you know, I don't know that there'll be a coming out party or anything, but CFRN is proud to announce that we now have exclusive rights to the Mind of a Trader trading series. Now that doesn't mean a thing to anyone who's never listened to an episode of the Mind of a Trader. Steve Croft, great guy, put this together, 160 episodes. We're about to start making them available to you members of the CFRN community. You're going to get a new episode. Each episode runs about 12 to 17 minutes. and you'll be able to listen to a fresh episode each and every day. That's how you're going to start your day. You're going to get up, you're going to go straight to CFRN.net, you're going to listen to today's episode, today's lesson, and then by the time the market's open, boy, you're going to be pumped and raring to go. This is good stuff, quality content. And for us to be able to offer that to our community, I'm very excited. It's going to make, I promise you, it's going to make a world of difference to a lot of you in regards to your trading. We already talk about a lot of important things like learning to think in probabilities and so many of this is going to be icing on the cake for you. Okay, I'm just at the moment I'm looking at a couple of different options for how I'm going to deliver the content. Basically, you'll come to the site and you'll listen. Okay. Now, for partners, it's going to be a little bit different. In the members area of the website, you'll have access to, I think it's going to be, I believe it'll be 5 to 7 episodes. So in other words, you'll have the whole week's worth in a folder in the members area so that you can go through, listen to all 5 or 7 episodes for that week prior to the partners meeting. Take notes, and then the first 15 to 30 minutes of the partners meeting on Thursday night, we'll spend talking about what we learned from those episodes of The Mind of a Trader. And to our partner who got me motivated to go out and secure those rights, that bell's for you. So with that, Michael, I guess I'll take back the charts if you're all done.
Yep, all set. All set.
Everybody out there looking at each other, scratching their head and other body parts going, huh? What did that guy say? Huh? Mind of a what? A who? Mind of a traitor. What is that? So you'll find out. No, you're really going to love it. It's just going to – you're going to wake up each day looking forward to – Steve is a great guy. Not only is he a great trader and has a great mind – mind of a trader. He has a great mind. But he has this incredibly soothing voice, right? And it just, it'll help calm your nerves before you head into the trading day. Just a win-win situation all the way around for everybody. So I'm excited. Now, Iris, I'm going to get back to your question tomorrow. Convince myself. That's deep. That's deep. All right, we're off to Vegas, guys. Talk to our friends, David Williams from PageTrader.com and Miss Robin Dane, the trading coach, who I believe is just back from New York City. So don't touch your radio dial. We're going to pause for a brief station identification. We'll be right back with you.
You're listening to CFRN, a community of believers who trade for a living. To learn more about who we are, what we do, and how we do it, call toll-free 1-866-928-3310, and we'll send you out a no-obligation information kit absolutely free. 866-928-3310.
Good morning, Dwayne.
David, good morning to you. And Robin, good morning to you. I'm in the process of getting your mic open, so stand by. And it's open.
Good morning. It's a fabulous day here in sunny Las Vegas where there's no...
I'm sorry. It's what kind of day? What kind of day?
I think she just lost her mic. I think she just lost her. Yeah. Okay. Barely hear her to begin with, and then I think she just disappeared.
We all know what she said. She said it's a nice day in Las Vegas.
Las Vegas, maybe?
Yeah, there
there
she
you
is.
Are.
There she is.
You're back.
Now do you have me? Now do you have me?
Yeah, mm-hmm. You need to get closer to your mic, though.
Yes, no?
Yes.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
It's a
can you hear your, can you hear now yourself?
Now it's a fabulous day. Sorry, all my buttons were in the wrong direction.
Hey, Robin, how are you enjoying your new home? Living in your new place, in the new area, the whole thing?
I love my new home. I just absolutely love it. I'm absolutely going to end up buying here for sure. And, I'm real excited. I love the area. I love the location. You know, location, location, location.
That's fantastic. Mm-hmm.
And nothing's more than 3 blocks from my house that I need, which is outstanding.
That's fantastic. Well, I'm really happy for you. Robin went through, for the listeners, she went through a number of years, probably maybe four, and Robin, you correct me, but I think it was maybe 4 years of a tortured process that had to do with, short selling and God knows what else. Not short selling in the markets, not in the stock market. But finally...
Bank issues.
Yeah, and finally got it all resolved, and... I don't know how you did it, but you finally got out of that, and you're in a brand new place, and you're very happy. That's fantastic.
Yeah, brand new place, all good, out of the mortgage from hell, and out from under that, just the pressure. You know, you don't realize how your mind is consumed by stress when you have something like that that's kind of hanging over you. And when you finally get rid of it, it's like, whoa. And I didn't really, I thought I was managing it pretty good. But when it was finally gone, it was really, I could feel the difference in my attitude and everything. It was great. I mean, I really love where I am, and I'm meeting a lot of people. And I am now on the Citizens Committee for Spanish Trail for any kind of disaster.
You're appropriate for that.
That's right. That's why they were all excited when they found me. So, so if any kind of disaster happens and hits, I'm on the team that's going to help everybody out there. So I'm very excited about that, too. And I have some comments about that we had from our meeting last night for our CERT, or Citizen Emergency Response Team meeting, that I'm going to pass on to everybody. But I want to talk about... very quickly, if you've never heard of them, the most amazing orange that exists in the world. And that orange is called a Honeybell Florida orange. And honeybells only come out in January. They have, I think, two picking seasons. I don't know if one is February, one's January, but right now they're shipping. And you cannot get them in the stores. You have to order them. And there's a place called Cushman's, C-U-S-H-M-A-N, mm-hmm. Cushman Oranges, and they will ship you. These oranges are the most amazing oranges you will ever taste. You will never
really?
Have another. You will never have another.
I'm going
orange.
To get one right now. I'm taking my headset off. I'm getting me a Cushman orange.
Yeah. So I just ordered a big. Well, I just received my big stash of Cushmans that I give out to everybody, and. They get to experience them, and there's never been a person that said that is the most amazing orange I've ever eaten.
What is the quality of the taste of the orange? What is the difference? Is it just richer, sweeter?
Tons of juice. Like you can do 3 oranges, and you'll have a full glass of juice, and it doesn't have an acidy taste. It's just pleasant. It is just fabulous, and I used to have. Trouble with my stomach with, acidy kind of foods and peppers and spicy foods. So I don't do spicy foods. And orange juice used to bother me. But this is the only kind of orange juice I can drink because I don't have that reaction. So it's really good. I mean, it's just really fabulous. And I'm not overly giving this a big plus 10. I've gotten them for years. My mom used to have trees on her property in Florida that we used to actually just pick the honeybells and take them home. I've been doing them for years. I mean, have them for years since I've been in my 20s. And they're fabulous. They're just incredible.
Huh.
Just incredible. Honeybell. oranges.
For those of you that eat at sushi or Japanese food, they often end the meal
yes.
with sliced, cleverly sliced oranges that are really, really good.
Yeah,
and I've always wondered where they... Yeah, and I think they may put some kind of a sauce or something on them that makes them extra good. They're always extra good, and I don't know if
I have to admit, those are really fabulous in that restaurant. And
what is that?
I think those are navels, though. Those are navels.
Yeah, but I think there may be some...
They get them from somewhere special.
Yeah,
that they know that they're...
So you've tasted them, and you agree with me. There is something particularly good about those.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But everything at that restaurant is good. So, it's not unusual. When you go to a good restaurant, these guys buy from the same growers. They get their fish shipped from the same place because they know, that it's the best of the best.
Mm-hmm.
They gave a television show about one chef in California, and they made a list of all the places that she gets her ingredients from. And she literally will search out from where's the best place to get oregano, where's the best place to get this. And she has a whole list. They don't get it from one grower.
Mm-hmm.
They get it from where the best is.
Hmm.
I just
went on the web and I see that they even are shaped a little bit like a bell.
Like a bell, yes.
Yeah, on the top, and that's very good. Well, that's great.
Yeah, they did that just for you. They did some marketing ploy. They made them in the shape of a bell. Yeah, they've been called honey bells for years. They're absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. So definitely, and they're very they're eatable oranges. Like, you don't have to juice them. I mean, there's a ton of juice, but you don't have to juice them. You can eat them, but they're very, very juicy. So you have to just be prepared that they'll be really juicy. So yeah, honey bells.
Well, that's good information.
Yeah.
Welcome to the Orange Radio Network.
Yeah,
talk about
radio. And then New York was. I brought the sunshine to New York, and when I left, the snow came. Poor Michael. Poor Michael's up there in the snow and the cold, and they're saying how cold it is. It's just terribly cold. I lucked out. My few days there, the weather seemed to hold off, and in fact, it was in the 60s. I think it was warmer there than it was in Vegas at the time, and got back home, and there came the winter blast again.
Mm-hmm.
So that was kind of interesting, and again last night I don't know if you want me to go talk about that now or not, but last night I went to my cert training and learned some very amazing things about fire, what causes fire, how to prevent fires, what to do if you're in a fire, and can you guess if your smoke alarm goes off? If your smoke alarm goes off, how much time do you have to actually get out before you're actually in danger? Do you have any kind of idea when the smoke alarm goes off?
Once the alarm finally goes off, how much time? Well, I'm going to guess it's surprisingly – no, I don't know. Let me just say I don't know. How about that?
David, anything? Any idea?
I'm going to guess that you best get out real pretty like.
30 seconds.
Yeah.
30 seconds. Because, and what's the reason for that? Well, by the time the smoke detector actually goes off, a lot has happened, and a fire can, smoke will come out first.
Well,
it depends
on what
the fire is.
My smoke alarm goes off when my wife's cooking. Not because she burnt the food, but because she's cooking something
smoke.
That has a lot of smoke, so.
Yeah, yeah.
And did you know if you live in a two-story home that you're supposed to have one of those rope ladders that you throw out the window?
Yep, throw out the window. And
I don't think it's
plan.
The law, but as foster parents, you're supposed to...
Teach your kids.
You're supposed to have those ladders in your home.
Yep.
If you have children that are in the foster care system, you're supposed to have that means of egress. 30 seconds, that's interesting.
And then to give them, and always have two exit routes. And know that most people don't die from fire, from being burned.
Smoke inhalation.
Exactly, smoke inhalation. And that's why it's so critical to, if there is smoke in a place and you're trying to get out, do you know what you're supposed to do?
Stop, drop, and roll.
Stop, there you go. Oh, you're good. Stop, drop, and roll.
Hey,
drop to the ground. Good.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
No, you finish.
You drop to the ground because that's where the most oxygen is. You want to get to your exit as quickly as possible, physically possible. And, if you have the opportunity or are close to water or something, you take a wet washcloth and put that over your nose and your mouth. Your eyes will literally not be able to open once the smoke hits. So the key thing is to feel your way around with one hand or one direction, knowing which way to go. So like, if they have us doing an exercise where we're supposed to get drunk, but I don't drink. So I have to blindfold myself. Somebody's got to turn me around till I'm disoriented, and then I have to find my way out of my bedroom in 30 seconds and see if I can do that. And so what happens is, you will be disoriented. You will not be able to see. Your eyes will not be able to open, and you have to feel your way out. So it's very, very important to know where your exits are, where your physical exits are. But you wanted to say something, Dwayne? Go ahead.
Well, no, I was just going to say when I was 8 years old,
mm-hmm.
maybe seven, but I'm thinking. It could have been seven, but probably eight. I'm gonna bare my soul here.
Mm-hmm.
Dwayne was a little bit afraid of the dark.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so Dwayne had a nightlight in his bedroom.
Mm-hmm.
And one night Dwayne awoke in the middle of the night, and his bed was on fire.
Yikes!
Up in flames. Now.
Yikes.
Nightlights have a little protective shield over them for a reason, okay? Dwayne, because he was afraid of the dark at that young age, had removed that little cover, right?
Oh, my
because
goodness.
It would give more, it gave more light that way. And so that would push the monsters or the boogeyman or whatever they were, back into the dark. You understand this is the thinking of a child.
A child.
And so what had happened, and of course my bed was not like right up against the nightlight, but
mm-hmm.
at some point during the night as I was sleeping, I kicked the cover and it just happened to land, one part of the blanket just happened to land right on top of that little bulb.
Oh my goodness.
And this was back before, I don't even know if they'd invented smoke alarms back then, but certainly we did not have one in that little apartment on Manassas Drive. All I know is I awoke and immediately realized this was not a bad dream. And my little brother, who's 4 years younger than me, he slept in the bed across from me. It was like bunk beds, but we didn't have them stacked up. They were just both flat side by side. I started screaming, "Mom, my bed's on fire." And so she came running in. And she assessed the situation, and we went to the kitchen. We got some wet towels, and we threw them on it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we started carrying bowls of water. And then about that time, the fire department arrived, and they drug the mattress out into the yard. The firemen did. And that mattress laid out there and smoldered.
Yeah.
Now, the firemen, they hosed that thing down really, really well. But that thing smoldered for days.
Yep.
Now,
that's
you want to know what one of the most traumatic parts of that whole experience was? One of the firemen said to me, once, everybody was calmed down and, there was no imminent threat to life, one of the firemen said, "So you alerted your mom and your brother, and then you helped carry the bowls of water to get this." And I was like, "Yeah." And he told me what a brave young man I was.
Yeah.
And he told me how I deserved some kind of an award or something. And, we have like this thing that like a junior, some kind of deal, right?
Yeah.
He told me that because of my act of bravery, and he was just being nice to a little kid,
No.
That they were going to give me this award.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to tell you something. I lived on edge for the next couple of weeks because I didn't know if they would show up at the door or the phone would ring or maybe there'd be a parade. I mean, I didn't know. I was 8 years old.
Yeah.
Nothing ever happened.
Oh, no.
That did more
That's
of a
terrible.
Whammy on me. No, I'm just saying, that did more of a whammy on me than actually, I mean, it's pretty frightening to wake up and your bed's on fire. I mean, this is like right out of some really bad horror movie. And, you know, what did you do last summer that you wake up, your bed's on fire? But, parents, if your children are afraid of the dark, number one, don't make them feel ashamed because that went away, you know.
Sure.
I think that night cured me. I don't think I was ever afraid of the dark again after that. But if your child is afraid of the dark, number one, don't try to shame them out of it. Okay, talk to them, be logical about it. But if they use a nightlight, you make sure that that thing is far away from their bed, and you make sure that they get the kind that you can't remove the little protective covering. That's probably the best suggestion.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Plus, you know, when you promise it, children are funny. You know, when you ask them to do something and say, "Oh, I forgot," but if you promise them something like a gift or a toy or something like you say, they will not forget. They will just not forget. And that's a terrible thing to do, to promise a child that age and not follow through with it, because you're right, they hang on that. And in those days, you know, we didn't have a lot of stuff. So when somebody promised you something little like that, it was a big deal. I mean, it was a big deal. I can remember a time I went on a television show, and the same thing, I won a gift, and the gift never came. And my mother called that station back and forth and back and forth, and I never got it. And I still to this day am waiting for my Gene Autry dishes, my Gene Autry cowgirl dishes, and I had to be 4 or 5, and I still remember the name, I still remember everything, I remember what they look like, and I never got them, and boy, mine's like crap.
Now, another similar situation, but there was nothing life-threatening here. I had a teacher, I can't remember, 4th grade, 6th grade, I don't remember, but somewhere in that general area. There was some kind of a big test. They didn't have the Ames test back then, but it was some kind of a test that the whole class had to take, or the whole school, and there was some significance, whatever. And Miss Robinson, who liked to wear, you know, never mind. I'm not even going to go into let's just say that mini skirts were the fad, and plastic zip-up boots that were supposed to look like leather, you know. But anyway, I was just a little boy. And anyway, I kind of maybe had a little bit of a crush on the teacher. And so the test gets passed out, and she's trying to get everybody to calm down and just do the doggone test. And in a flippant sort of a way, she said, "And there'll be a prize for whoever's done first." That's all my ears heard, is there'll be a prize for whoever's done first. I wanted the prize, and I wanted to please the teacher, who, I don't know, maybe I had a little crush on. I didn't hear the sarcasm in her voice or the flippant manner. All I know is that I was finished, pencil down, and test in the tray long before any of the other students. And I was just sitting back there so smug and just feeling real good about myself, because I knew, you know, eventually when the test was over, she would, you know, call me to the front of the room, and I would be presented with the prize, right, the undefined prize. Well, the bell rings for lunch, and everybody line up out in the hall, and so we all go line out in the hall, and, you know, I'm like halfway down the line, and I kind of stick my hand out. I go, "Miss Robinson?" And she's like, "Yes, what?" I go, "Did you forget something?" She's like, "What? What did I forget?" I said, "Well, you said there'd be a prize for whoever finished the test first." And I'll never forget what she said. She goes, she just started laughing at me in front of the whole class. And she goes, "What did you want, a butter bean sandwich?" And then she turned around and said, let's go. And everybody marched off to lunch. And, man, you know, okay, maybe I was overly sensitive. All right, I'm sorry. I'm just telling you that be careful what you say to kids. That stung. I was embarrassed in front. Number one, apparently I wasn't as smart as I thought I was because I fell for the old Butterbean Sandwich Prize, you know. But it was embarrassing in front of the other students, and I carried that with me for a long time. Hopefully it's not. I'm not having sleepless nights over it now or anything, but be careful with your kids, what you say to them. And it's so hard. I say things every day that I wish I could put that toothpaste back in the tube or unring that bell. And every day I have to go, doggone it, Dwayne, when are you going to learn? Maybe tomorrow, you know. So you just keep trying, but it's important.
Because
it really is.
They will remember, and they could carry it. They could carry it with them. You do have a... if I may give you a compliment, you do have a propensity to have the need to be right. And I think that comes from things like that, you know, that if you know you're going to promise something, you know, the right thing to do is this, and the right thing, the appropriate way a person should react should be this. So you do have a very strong sense of, you know, right and wrong.
Yeah.
And you stick to it. You absolutely stick to it. And that comes from, you know, the experiences that you've had. That's a good thing. That's not a bad thing. That's a good thing.
Is that a good thing? Okay.
It's all good. Well, good. Sure, of course it's a good thing.
Now, guys, she's talking, there is a difference here between knowing what's right and wrong and being right and wrong in your trading.
Right.
Those are two different universes. Please don't ever mix those two up because you will become a basket case. And it'll take a very expensive shrink, a very long time at $50 an hour to unweave that basket. So,
they're more than 50 an hour now.
Yeah.
$50 an hour was like in the 70s.
Okay. It won't take me that long, but I'll charge you $7.50.
Okay, Lucy on Charlie Brown now charges $50 an hour.
I have my own story, and now that we're telling stories, I want to tell one of my disappointment stories. There was a toy store near my home that, not so near, but I had to walk a decent distance to get there, but when you're a kid, you walk everywhere, and I would go in the toy store, and I don't remember exactly how, but there was a man that worked there, and I think he may have been one of the owners of the store, and it wasn't even a toy store. It was some kind of a store for things for babies. It was a store related to babies, things that carry babies and cribs and all kinds of things. And so I distinctly don't remember exactly how I got in the conversation with the guy, but the man told me that he had a whole trunk. I told him I really liked magic, and when I was young, and I still do today, you know, magicians thing, and he said he had a whole trunk of magic, and that he would bring it in. And I said, "Well, what are some of the tricks that you have?" And he described this one special quarter that you could, these two quarters you could make one balance on top of another because the ridges were made special or something. And at my little mind, at whatever that age was, I thought, "Oh, that's the neatest thing." So I would go back to that store two times a week, sometimes more, and ask him if he brought the trunk in. If he had brought his trunk with all the magic in. And he would say, no, I'd forgotten it. I'd forgotten it. And I must have gone, I don't remember how long, but it was months and months. And I started coming less often, but when I finally went in one day, and I said, well, do you have the trunk? And he looked at me and he said, I don't really have any of the trunk, you know, son, or whatever he called me. He goes, I don't have the magic or anything. And I just told you that. And I remember... You know, as an adult, we have all these filters and the way that we think we should act under those conditions. Mm-hmm. As a child, you just kind of look forward for a second, and all of that picture just kind of folds away, and you're just left standing there. And he wasn't mean. He wasn't being mean, but he just finally knew that he had to tell me that
he had to finally,
I don't have a trunk. I'm coming way too often, you know, for him to keep it up. So he told me, and I remember being disappointed. I remember thinking, how come he made me wait so long to tell me that he didn't actually have this trunk. And, you know, the disappointment, leaving, sure. And thinking, wow, that was a lot of, effort to find that out. And you just these are, everyone has these lessons in life. We all do, on one level or another.
I'll bet you everybody could think of one at least.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Now, do you think that his thinking was that eventually you would just forget about
Stop.
It?
Stop. Exactly.
Yes, that's what his thinking was.
Yeah.
But see, then when it became evident that you weren't going to forget about it, then he had some cleaning up to do.
And, he did. And he did. He said, look, I don't really have a trunk. And he was nice about it and all that stuff. But it just seemed so odd at that age to think, you know, that we would go through this whole dance.
In your mind, at that age, Dave, what did you think of him? That he was mean? That he was a liar? That he...
I think I thought of him, I didn't think of him as mean. I think I thought of him as somebody who had a propensity to tell a story, or, you know, he just told me a story for whatever reason. And I, now that I'm an adult, it seems odd to me. I, as an adult, wouldn't necessarily want to say that to a child and have him come back, you know, however many times. But I do remember thinking he was probably a little odd to have done that. I thought that's a kind of an odd thing, because I went through a lot of, I don't remember my exact thoughts, but I do remember not being really, really mad, but I do remember feeling...
I was sad.
Yeah, I was feeling, I felt let down that, you know, I was really interested to see what he had. You know, when you have nothing and you're just a child and everyone else is the people that have
the somethings,
and you're the one that has the nothings, and, those things mean a lot to you.
Did you ever go to that store again?
I never went to that store again. I was never inside that store. The only reason I went to that store was, I think I wandered into it one day, but I never went back in there. And ultimately, when I've gone back to my community that I lived in Northridge, California, of course, that store and many others are long gone. But I also had good experiences, though. There was another store down the road that was a toy store that I went in and asked if they needed to do any work for them. I said I'd work for free, and they had me do little things. It was just a little tiny toy store. Mm-hmm. And one day, somebody there gave me a nickel, and for the day's work, I literally ran home that day. I mean, it was a long distance. I could not wait to tell my parents that I was special enough to be paid to do work, you know, that had actually happened. I could not believe that somebody had given me a nickel to... You know, nice. To do the charm. And what was I, 6 years old, or I don't remember what it was, but something
but
like that.
That's huge.
It was huge. And, you know, my parents were very supportive, and they were smiling, and it was funny. At the same time, it meant a lot. So everybody goes through those experiences. We have good and bad experiences. And many of those, like what Dwayne was saying, many of them really do become part of our later adult life, and we're always protecting ourselves from that in some way, shape, or form. And that's a heavy burden to carry around. You don't really have to do it and all that. But we do, you know, a lot of that happens. People conditioned, you know, in certain ways, certain things happen, you know, and so.
Well, that's why I always say, you know, when you come to trade, your emotional baggage will raise its ugly head because these memories and these circumstances and beliefs and experiences will reflect on how you execute and how you react to your trading and the emotions that are there. So, you know, they do have an effect. You know, you may not notice them right away. You may not notice that it's a direct effect from your toy store incident or whatever, but they do pop up again when you get a trade in some way.
No, they do. It's funny, the whole idea of getting, you know, just getting, the concept of receiving, getting something, go out and getting something, really triggers a lot in people. Yeah. And I've seen it in myself, I've seen it in others. As soon as there's a getting involved, all kinds of things come into play.
I mean, you know, people come to Vegas to see what they can get, you know, to see if they're going to hit the big one. You know, they, when I go into the casinos and I love to watch people, and on occasion I'll just sit there and just watch people play, and it's really amazing how they are so addict. They can get totally addicted to it, like alcohol, like anything else. They get totally addicted to it.
Mm-hmm.
And the joy that they get when they hit something, you know, if they hit something. And the joy that other people get when they see somebody hit something. There's always a huge crowd around, and they joke, what did you get? What did you get? Oh, I hit $1,000. Wow, that's pretty neat. Oh, I can get it too. And it's just this you know, the thing of getting is important. And then, you know, I think nowadays it's different for kids than we had it, because I didn't have a lot when I was growing up. I had a few toys, but I certainly didn't have what these kids have today. And, you know, to spend money on a toy was a big deal. And to save up enough to have a toy and to work, you know, like Dwayne said, just to have a job, or you said, to have a job, you know, to be able to work. And mm-hmm. girls weren't allowed to work. Boys could work, you know, as 13, 14 as a paper route, but girls mm-hmm. weren't allowed. So mm-hmm. I was discriminated against when I was very young.
Aww.
But I got my lemonade stand out there, and I showed them. And I had a haunted house. I was very entrepreneurial as a kid. I had a haunted house that they could pay to come in and go through my haunted house.
Aww.
And I tore apart my mother's living room and used to make tents and things that people have to crawl through.
All right. Well, I'm going to tell one last story for me,
okay.
which will show people my level of intelligence. I don't know what grade we were in, but we might have been in second or third grade, and a friend of mine in school, and I think I've told the story once before, perhaps. We went into the school library. This is an elementary school, and we got the idea in our mind that the people that run the library would be very happy with us if we just would put the books all in order, because they're all different shapes and sizes. So we put all the books in order according to size, rather than where they're supposed to be in title and subject and all that stuff. So we took the big, tall books and the medium books and the small books, and we put them all together, and then we got into a lot of trouble for that.
Oh, now see, that's, you know, that's...
We were trying to do good.
Things.
We thought they would be happy.
Of course.
Actually thought they were going to be happy.
Yeah.
And they would say, God, thank you so much, because we had no idea of how the whole thing worked. And, yeah, they weren't very happy with that.
Oh.
I remember the disappointment going, oh, boy, that's not good.
So. I think the gift of having your children is the freshness that they bring when they interpret things. And, you know, I'm working
yes.
with these tennis players now, and the interpretation of words are very interesting when you don't have a lot of longevity in your life. If you're 15 mm-hmm. or 6 or 7, the mm-hmm. amount of words and your meaning of words is totally different, and how they translate is different, but it's so fresh and real that it's
mm-hmm,
and honest. I mean, it can't be more honest, which is great. I'd like to share with you maybe four or five more things, if I may. I hope people will indulge me, and then I'll turn it over to David for his markets, if I can do that. I just want to do a couple little things on this safety thing, if I could.
Okay.
Is that all right?
All right.
Highest incident within the house for fires, there's two rooms. What would they be? I guess.
Kitchen.
Yep.
And bedroom.
Number one. Nope. Laundry room.
Laundry room. Why is that?
Laundry room. And, well, because of the lint that goes into your dryer.
Oh,
you've got fire
yeah.
in your dryer. And so one of the things I wanted to bring up, because, you know, I don't do this enough either. I know that you take the lint trap out and you clean the lint trap out, but you've got lint that goes and blows out through the hoses in the back, and when, you know, those are blowing and then the dryer stops, that lint collects into the hose. And so it's very important to vacuum that hose, or somebody said to even use a leaf blower and blow the stuff out of the hose that goes from the back of your dryer, because that's one of the biggest areas that can catch
fire. As seen on TV product.
Yep.
That's
yep.
supposed
it's a little
to,
brushy
to
thing.
Do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, you can do that, or it goes down there and it vacuums it out. But definitely make the extra effort once a month or whenever you can. And also don't forget under your dryer, you know, to go underneath there and get the lint out from underneath there, because you do have fire and gas, you know, that's going on when you're drying your clothes. And we do that all the time. Two other things. Do not leave the dryer running when you leave the house or when you go to sleep. And I know a lot of people do that. But those are two times when you can catch fire. You probably don't have a smoke detector in that room. And that thing, and that is one of the most flammable things possible. If you go camping and you want something flammable, collect the lint that you have and use it in your fire. It'll burn faster, as fast or as not as much as hair, but hair smells terrible. But lint will actually do that. Ways to put out a fire, kitty litter. Okay, kitty litter is a great way to put out a fire.
Yeah, I've heard of. Okay, good tip.
So kitty litter. You know, make sure you have two exit routes out of wherever you are, you know, two places that you can exit the room, not just one. Which direction, have an escape plan. Have a plan with your family that if something should happen, that you have a meeting place. They say that a lot of accidents occur when somebody believes that there's somebody left in the fire when they're not in the fire, and they go back to save them, they lose their life, and a meeting place. So if you have a fire, something happens in the home, have a plan with your family where you're going to meet so that you collectively figure out who's there and who's not there. Never enter a room that's filled with smoke. Never, never, never. You will not come out. Huh. Never enter a room filled with smoke. Wait till the professionals get there with their equipment. And very, very critical. Very, very critical. And so I guess the main thing is to make sure that you have a plan. Get the lint out of everything. Oh, check your plugs. I'm going around my house now, checking them now too. You know how you put your vacuum cleaner into a plug and then you go from one room to another and whatever. And then you go to move from one room and instead of going to the plug socket and pulling your plug out, you pull the cord and you kind of drag that with you and then put it into the next socket. Watch your plugs. Watch that your connections are not frayed. Check all your connections. And especially watch if you've got any kind of mobile, what they call those octopuses that you can plug many things into. Make sure that those are in a place that, you know, will not catch fire or that they're okay. You know, invest in something that's worthwhile, not a cheap one, because those can get caught on fire. Just check gas lines and things like that. And
you forgot one really good one.
What's that?
Own a fire extinguisher.
Oh, I was just going to say, yeah, fire extinguisher. And with the fire extinguisher, very, very important, there's a little dial on the fire extinguisher, and there is a solid, like, powder that mixes with the air within the fire extinguisher. Over time, that powder settles to the bottom of the fire extinguisher, and that little dial will show the effectiveness that it's not effective. If you take that fire extinguisher and you shake it, or you put it on the ground and you roll it in a circle, it'll redistribute the powder within the air, within the canister, so that it will reactivate it and make it viable. Otherwise, if you use a fire extinguisher that has been sitting and that hasn't been done to, what will happen is you'll turn it on and the air will blast out, but you'll have nothing happen. All of the stuff that you need will be stuck at the bottom. So shake your fire extinguishers on a regular basis and make sure that the dial is working. Always test your fire extinguisher before you hit the fire. Test your fire extinguisher before you hit the fire.
Those are great suggestions, great comments. Okay. Most people don't think about fire. Most people don't think about what
they don't.
Could happen and what, you know, that's
really good.
And it's fast.
They showed film last night, and I'll tell you something, it woke me up. It just, when you see how fast something can be ignited and how it smolders, you know, like Dwayne, like the mattress, they had a little smoldering thing in a chair, and once that thing caught fire, it was literally just amazing how fast it got consumed. They did it in an experimental room, and the firefighters almost lost a second building, and they were experienced when they did this test and filmed it. That's how unpredictable fire can be and how powerful it can be.
I was going to say, we had out here back in 1980, what was then the MGM Grand, had a terrible fire, and people in the building It started on the casino level, and people that were on the casino level that were able to get out, and unfortunately some people did die in that fire, smoke, all the other stuff. But they said that the fire started at one corner of the casino, and within 3 seconds, the whole wall was on fire. Imagine how big a casino is. It just burst into flames. It was like an explosion of fire. And until you're in one, you really don't know how bad it can be. You really want to take the extra effort to make sure
you may not see it.
Protected.
You know, the thing is, it could be totally behind the wall, smoldering and doing its thing, and then all of a sudden it bursts out of the wall, which is probably what happened there. And so there was a fire behind the wall that was no
indication
anything was happening, and then all of a sudden you get this flash, and it the fire
everything's
hits the
on fire,
oxygen,
right.
And then it just really goes crazy. So that's why, you know, you don't want to have oxygen on a fire, because that's what the fire will get drawn towards the oxygen.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, be careful. That's all I'm going to say. I know you want to get to the markets. I'll let David do his thing. Thank you for listening, and I hope that helps a little.
Those are some good suggestions. And one of the ideas I got from that is I'm going to make myself a little cassette tape of a dryer turning, because it helps you go to sleep. So you can one of those sound generators of just a dryer turning for people who...
In the dead of winter, we have a semi-loud fan in our bedroom for that very purpose. My wife and I, we both like to watch TV as we're falling asleep, and then the TV will turn itself off after a bit. There's something but there's something about having that fan, that constant, that hum, that just
that hum,
lulls you into whatever.
It's like a mantra.
Because sometimes we'll go to a hotel where there's no fan, and I'll wake up in the middle of the night, and it's eerily quiet.
Yeah.
And so I reach for my iPhone or my iPad and my earbuds, and I got to get some kind of noise going on in my head. Now, trust me, I have thought this through, and I don't know that my solution is the best solution. When it makes you uncomfortable to be alone with your thoughts, it might be time to think about what you're thinking about.
Yeah.
What do you think, Dave?
Well, I think the sleep portion of it is a little – some people do like the railroad car track sound, the dryer sound, and that's probably a little different than being alone with your thoughts. It's sort of like a way of getting your – you know, it's kind of like a mantra, something steady in the background that you can kind of detach your – but I do like the idea of – we've talked about that so many times, about the watchfulness, mindfulness, about what goes through your head, because it can – many, many, many things are still alive in you, in me, that have – they're just living off of you, like a little – what are those fish that live off of their fish? You know, they hook onto them. And
leeches?
They're living. Leeches or whatever.
There's a fish that goes onto another fish that eats the parasites off the other fish.
Yeah.
Is it a sucker
there was,
fish?
I don't know, but I remember seeing a program recently where, I mean, this sounds ridiculous, but there are fish in the ocean that will open their mouth and allow other fish to go in and clean their teeth.
It's like
they go to the, honey, I'll be back in 20. I'm going to get my teeth cleaned over here by the rock and the sand over there, and then I'll be back. As soon as I get my teeth cleaned, see you.
I think they're pretty smart.
That's funny.
Yeah,
it's true.
So it's a symbiotic relationship where somehow it's in their genome where these certain fish know that there's something on their teeth that they can eat. That cleaning the teeth is good. We know that now. And these fish will open their mouth. They won't eat these little fish. They let them clean their teeth, and there you are.
Yeah.
What a world.
And there's a
bird like a Disney thing. It's almost like a Disney cartoon, really, in real life.
And there are birds that will do it on the back of a, like a cow, do the same thing. They'll eat the parasites off the cow. The birds do it. So
apparently, there's a couple of those kinds of fish: a pilot fish, a lamprey, a remora, a wrasser fish, and a clown fish.
Oh, there you go. Tons. Hmm. Tons of fishes.
And those are from different people. A couple different people contributed on that.
Great. Okay. See, we've got a very educated group of people here.
We do.
I know that.
We really do.
They're very bright. They're very bright.
Well, guys, you want to go to the market?
I'm at the point where I think we should be listening to their radio program. Yeah.
Oh, let me say this again. For anyone in the audience that would like to participate in the show, you know you can type into the chat box. You can also call toll-free 866-928-3310. Either Bert or Leslie will answer, and if you would say, could you please patch me through to the radio program, they will, okay? So you can just call right in, and instead of having to type, maybe it's a lengthy question or whatever it might be, or you just want to hear the sound of your own voice, call in. We're now a call-in show, 866-928-3310. All right, light them up.
There you are. Light them up.
As they say in Radio Land. All right, David, you want to go S&P?
Sure. I'll talk a little and whatever you'd like to throw in. Obviously, today's a relatively quiet day, and so has the last several days been a quiet day. The market's very comfy up here. That means sort of complacent. They're not too worried. No one is anxious to sell off all their holdings, here, obviously, because the market's trading very nicely. And I think I mentioned, I'm not sure if I did or not, but we actually think that there's something relatively imminent coming into tomorrow, plus or minus a day, which is the 23rd, January 23rd, Thursday. This is a shortened week. And so the market is building up to that date. And real bigger, longer picture, we've been through a number of weekly turning points that we've talked about on the program, the December 30th weekly top, and then the more recent bottom, the January 13th weekly bottom. These are turning points that we work with and forecast. And then the most recent daily top of January 15th. All of that has been pretty – go ahead.
Well, I just want to add something to what you're saying, because you're expecting something kind of big tomorrow.
Well, yeah, the 23rd is a date where there's forces at work we think may affect the market.
Hey, guys, look at my screen because I have brought up the economic reports from our toolbar, which you can download for free on our homepage. But let's go to tomorrow, Thursday the 23rd. There's a German PMI news event. That's big. Volatility expected. Core retail in Canada. But now we get to the U.S. We got initial, but even that's just medium. The only high-impact report that we have tomorrow is existing home sales. That's it. And if we scroll on down to Friday in the U.S., we got nothing. In fact, there are very few economic reports due out Friday worldwide. So if David is correct, and he often is with these things, there's a high probability that he'll be correct. My point here is it's not going to come from some type of economic news report. It might be, a man-made disaster or natural disaster or any kind of news that just might be spur-of-the-moment news. Somebody makes a speech or an announcement. You follow what I'm saying, guys?
Yes.
It's not coming from – so that makes your statement very interesting to me. What will be the thing? Now, remember, there's always the argument, folks, that which comes first? The news or the technicals, does the news happen to fulfill the technicals, or we've had that conversation many times over the last 8 years. So David is making a statement today, and let's see what happens. This will give us
this isn't a huge thing. It's not like a big volatility cycle, but it's big enough for us to make note of, and we talked about it in our and either something either begins on that day or there's something indicated for that, and it's especially important after a series of very quiet days, something like this. Does the man not have a job because of the economy, or does he not have a job because he doesn't want to work, or whatever? It's like you got all these different things you can say. Does the market respond to the news, or does the news respond to the market? It really is a circle, and the power spins around in a circle. Everything ends up, I think, ideally, in the end, somehow a really big circle. The old saying, there's really no straight lines. I don't know if you've heard that before.
but it doesn't matter how straight you make it. If it goes out long enough, whatever error is in it shows up over distance, and everything ends up being a circle. So,
any indication as to whether it will send the markets higher or lower?
No. At this point, we would have put a report out for it. Obviously, the market's in a very good position. I mean, you could look at that and say, well, it's in a great position, but the market is much more, that's too plain-faced for the market to just say, well, they're in a strong position now, so therefore they're going to go higher. But we're going to try to trade it, as you will, Duane, and anyone else. But when the markets are not showing the really easy and obvious stuff, you just have to take a break from it and not worry yourself too much about it. Take it in your stride. And the S&P is in that position right now. So we're going to wait, and we'll see if tomorrow brings.
And that is
anything.
So hard to do. It's so easy to
it
say.
Is.
It's so hard to do. I mean, you woke up. I mean, you're in an extra good mood. You meditated an extra 5 minutes. You used your special weekend body wash, even though it's Thursday.
Oh, well, that's it right there. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you went ahead and did that. You've got something coming.
I mean, you sit down at the platform, and then there's nothing there.
Yeah.
And a lot of traders will get themselves into trouble because sitting on your hands is not part of your business plan or your trading plan. Well,
then make it part of it.
You
make
need
it
to
part
make
of it.
It. You need to make it part of your plan. Absolutely.
Yeah. I've said this before, and I want to say it again. I consider everything part of my business, not just my business. In other words, if nothing is happening that day, that's part of my business. I'm here and I'm recognizing that nothing's happening. I'm doing the work of understanding that I shouldn't do anything. I mean, there is some effort in that. And I do really believe that you'd be much wiser to think in those terms than you would be necessarily to say, hey, gosh, this depresses me. I had nothing happen. I've noticed, and probably you have as well, have you seen this, that on days where there's very little action or a couple of days where there's little action, you often feel worn out because you are working so hard to try to find something where there is nothing. So you're working harder to find these things. Don't work yourself so hard. It really is a lot easier than that. Trading isn't easy, but it can be simple. I don't remember whatever
exactly.
The line
that's
is.
That's our slogan. Trading's not easy, but it can be simple.
I was just throwing that in there for you, but I want to say that it really should be. It should be easier than that. It should be easier than the days where we're all working so hard to try to find something, and at the end of the day you're thinking, I'm exhausted, and I didn't trade, I didn't make anything, nothing happened, and I'm exhausted. So just keep an eye on it and take it in your stride. Duane, do you have anything you want to cover on S&P?
Dave, I think I already covered pretty well. We've been traveling back and forth between these two zones, 35, 36, 41, 42, and it looking at the hourly chart, the obvious, I don't know about obvious, but it looks to me like the market does want to make that trip back down to the target at 37 again. That would be the fourth trip down. Beyond that, no, David, I don't have anything.
Okay. Well, you're going to hear me saying similar things like that in a quick run around the markets here. So let's do our quick run, and I'll point out a few things. Gold is another market that we are very interested in at all times. It's a fantastic market to trade. One of my favorites, honestly. Gold is really an excellent market. I don't know how to quantify that any further than that. It's just a beautiful market. It trades well. So there's not a lot happening in it. We do have an indication, and I don't think I'm too remiss to mention this. I think it might be useful. It's not an outright forecast, what I'm about to say, but it might be useful to some that it's not a forecast for this to happen. But if this week, the week of January 20th, if we do trade down at 1218, 1219, or a little lower, that's a very important potential start to something. And we'll talk more about that, but we haven't traded to those numbers yet. But for this particular week of January 20th, it is important for us if they do trade there. So I just mentioning that, even though the market's very quiet, and we'll continue to watch it. The Treasury bond market, we can zip through these pretty quick. It's pretty quiet. They had a reflective wave top back on January 13th. They sold off. They rallied. They're now pulling back, and it's likely they will continue to pull back into January 23rd. At that point, we may do something with the bonds. But as it stands right now, we're flat. Not a lot of commentary on that market either. The euro is another market that we're interested in for a number of reasons. There's actually quite a bit of indications in this market. If you look at this market, you can just go back in the past 4 weeks, 5 weeks. December 9th was an up closing week. December 16th was a down closing week. December 23rd was an up closing week. December 30th was a down closing week. January 6th was an up closing week. January 13th was a down closing week. Today, January 20th, this week, maybe will be an up closing week. This market has been very, very tricky, back and forth, very difficult for some people to trade, I believe. And we've talked about there's a big trading firm that went out of business, a trend-following type of firm that stopped their currency operations because of, in part, the difficulty of this market over the last 6 months. But we do believe that there is something really important cooking, and this takes us into February. So in much in the same way that the date, you know, for tomorrow, we think, hey, that there's something important building up into tomorrow plus or minus a day. Well, the same thing is true for the month of February in a much larger way relatable to this particular market. You know, and the market we're talking about is the euro. So let's go on from there because, you know, there's a lot we could say. We do have a forecast out on that. It's a two-level forecast. So we're waiting to see how the market handles that. So we're generally speaking, we're flat right now in most of these markets. The crude oil market, this is one market that's acting perfectly normally. And our friend LaVon, who trades with Bert Schlichter from Daniel's Trading, I'm only mentioning that because Bert is utilizing our Williams Edge calls to give them to a number of people. And this LaVon, who came on the program, his options trader guy, and a talented trader in his own right, doesn't need me. He doesn't need anybody. He can do it all on his own. But Bert does trade for him, and he's in a very nice position right now based on the reflected wave bottom of January 6th, the week of January 6th in crude. Crude's one of the few markets that's acting really nicely, and they're up strongly this week. And so I'm glad for him that he has he's in that position. For those of you, by the way, and I've mentioned this many times, Dwayne has mentioned it many times, Bert Schlichter is very familiar with Dwayne's work. Bert Schlichter is familiar with ours. And anybody who is using either can go to Bert Schlichter and have him trade or help you in some way effectively utilize what you're getting. And it can be very useful because not everybody can be in front of their computer all day long. I'm not even sure if it's healthy to be in front of your computer all day long, but be that as it may.
I wrote a little piece the other night, David, about negative screen time, about the very thing that you just spoke about.
Yeah.
In the beginning, you do need a lot of screen time, but you reach a point where it becomes, you know, what are you trying to prove? I won't go too deep into that. Anyone that has an interest can go read that. It's on the Google Plus page. But what you said about Bert, he understands your trading methodology. He understands our trading methodology. He actually uses both of our methodologies to put on and take off trades for Bert Schlichter. Now, think about the relationship you have with your broker, whoever your broker might be. Is this a pitch for Bert Schlichter? It is. His number, by the way, toll-free, 866-928-3310. He'll be happy to have a conversation with you about our system, David's system, about his services, what he can offer you. But my question to you is, does your broker understand the methodology that you use to trade? Now, honestly, I want you to think about this, okay, because you've got to, or hopefully after a few moments of reflection, you'll realize what a powerful one-two punch that is. you and another guy that, thank you, Robin, that understand and see the same things. Like, hey, Bert, I'm seeing this, and I heard that, and I want to do, and he can go, okay, I see. He might disagree with you. He might be able to point out, well, yeah, but hey, but what about this? Then you go, oh, yeah. See, because you guys are speaking the same language. So there's my pitch for Bert and Leslie today, the dynamic duo of E-Mini Futures.
There we are. It's good to have somebody to bounce ideas off of. If you stay in your own world too long, your own world gets a little weird. You need some outside. It really does. You need some outside input. It really helps. If you're anything like me, your own world gets a little weird. So how about that?
I agree.
I'm not afraid on public radio to say
yes,
I'm a little weird.
I
think you know that. Robin's met me.
I'm going to put
knows.
That phone number in the chat box, guys. Again, if you'd like to call in and be a part of this radio program today, just dial toll-free, 866-928-3310. Oh, I put the wrong number in the box. Stand by, 866-928-3310. Strike the first number. Go with this number, the one that just appeared in your chat box. Okay?
There we are.
And I'd like to just mention that we will have a Coach's Corner on Friday, which is at 12 o'clock Pacific Time and 3 o'clock Eastern Time. And if you've never been to Coach's Corner, we open it up and you talk about your trading psychology. I'll give you some techniques and tools that you can go through to try to move you through those challenges that you might be having. And it's your opportunity to, you know, get some other information other than the technical stuff from me.
Yeah.
And Dwayne.
Mm-hmm. I look forward to it. That's this Friday.
This Friday.
I still have the crude chart up, David. What market are we on right now?
Well, I was just going to leap over a couple more markets
because
there are
so many
clients. Do you have any
charts you wanted to show today?
I could, but I'll save them for a little more action tomorrow, Dwayne, honestly.
Okay.
One of the markets that we don't normally trade, we do watch it for the intention of trading it, but we don't get a lot of trades in it, is the cocoa market. And early this morning, we had an indication for March cocoa, which was trading at about 26.80 or so, to rally to 27.11 or 27.10 or higher. And they're trying to do that now. This is a kind of a setup. Yes, we're in March cocoa. This is a kind of setup that utilizes a couple of different principles, but in the end, the idea is to have a lead in the position and potentially hold for a bigger move than the initial target. So the initial target is really just a starting point for the market, and we'll see how that plays out. We don't talk a lot about the cocoa, because in general we don't see a lot of the kinds of setups for us that we're looking for, but in this particular case we have it. I think it'd be wise also for us just to wait roughly until tomorrow for the real more important, or Friday for the really big indications, because most of the markets, with a couple of exceptions, are really, natural gas is really having a great move today, but other than the few markets, they're very quiet, and you can all go home now.
Speaking of cocoa, Bruce had a question earlier. Would you ask David if he has any long-term outlook on coffee?
You know, we've talked about coffee before, and honestly, without Bert Schlichter here, I think it was Kay. I wonder if Bert, if he was around, if he could give us that signal.
On my screen, C doesn't do it. C brings up
no, it's a K. I think Bert had told me once, and I don't have the K.
Yeah. How about KCMH4? In fact, Bruce, tell us what your symbol is, since you had the question, if you would, please.
Yeah, there you go.
Coffee. And I'm not sure what platform Bruce is on. He might be on DT Pro. But that is the correct symbol, it looks like, for all of you who are on DT Pro, KCMH4.
I think I may have it right here, my symbol. I just may have.
We are trading March.
We are. I believe we are. I'm not 100% sure, to be honest with you. Coffee, has been in a huge downtrend, as everybody knows, and I don't have a direct immediate forecast, and I've promised in the past that I would put this up. Go ahead.
When you say in a huge downtrend, you mean the last, like, 10 days?
No, I was referring to on the longer term, going all the way back to May of 2011. I mean, it has just been a wipeout move. If you go, you have a monthly or a quarterly,
you know, but it won't go back as far as I want it to. So, I mean, I can get back into, let's see, how far can I go back?
Well, I'll give you an idea. It was up at 306, and it just recently made a bottom at $100.95. So it lost $206. I mean, it's a huge move. And this is over a couple of years. You know, April of 2011. Here we are in 2014. You know, it's had a big move. And in the and also, Duane, in the past 10 or 12 days, it's had a decent little decline as well.
Looks like I can get back as far as like October of 2012.
Okay, well, you're pretty close.
Now it's going to give me more data. Now it's giving me some more. Yeah, but yeah, I can see the big downtrend there.
Yeah. I don't have anything immediate on coffee, and we've sort of substituted cocoa in there, but I think coffee trades differently than cocoa in just the way it digests information and moves and all that. It may be interesting for us to finally put this up as a permanent market and see if we can do something with it. The New York markets, if there's a Globex for this, I would never suggest that you trade any floor-based market at this point with these. And if they have a Globex, you know, electronically traded E-mini for the coffee, then, yeah, it's worth taking a look at.
Richard's asking a question. We talked about this briefly yesterday. Any news on the Eurozone creating a Fed of their own, which, as we talked about yesterday, would be, I mean, we're the dominant player on the world stage. We're the only, you know, country of, you know, a developed nation that can just print money out of thin air. And the Fed does not need anybody's permission to do it. Not Congress, not the president, not nobody, not no way, not no how. And that's why it freaks a lot of people out. But we talked yesterday, there's talk of the Eurozone doing something similar. Richard, I don't have additional information. I've not specifically looked for that news. But if you, would you be willing to take on the task of following that story and maybe reporting back to us what you find?
I can tell you, Duane.
That's going to be a game changer.
Yeah, I can tell you that the original decision was going to be made either over the weekend or last week. It's been put off now probably until next week before that decision gets made. And one of the things that we've discussed a lot in our group is that something of size is going to be required news-wise to move the euro in the size that we think it's potentially going to move in. And this is very much the kind of news that would be ideal to do that. So
yeah,
it hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, it doesn't get much bigger than that.
No, it doesn't get much bigger than that. It's probably one of the bigger ones that's going to happen this year with regard to the currencies. And this would affect a number of currencies. So it should be interesting. And we don't really have any.
Do you know how many countries are in the Eurozone now?
No, I don't.
I don't. Off the top of my head, I don't either. I want to say 13, but that number might be way off. Thank you, Richard. Richard says he'll keep his eyes and ears open. Anyone in the audience know there was some country that was just admitted here recently? I forget who it was, but that brought it up to 13 or 18. I'm not sure. Hmm. But a lot of folks, I don't know how many of you remember when they first came out with the euro, and people said this won't work, it won't last, it's not going to happen. And then of course there was the talk that okay, here comes the one world currency and the one world government, and it's the fulfilling of Revelation. And you know, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. I don't know. David, I did hear this today. Two casinos in Vegas now accept the Bitcoin.
Now that is amazing.
Really?
Look at that.
Let me see if I can spot that article. I had it here. Go ahead and talk about anything. It'll take me a second to bring this up.
Well, I was just going to – go ahead, Duane. Go ahead, Robin.
I was just going to give you a quick update on the three stocks real quick on Zynga. Zynga is attempting to head in an up direction again, but it's literally sideways around the 350. I would not enter it at this point. Again, we're still kind of flatlining, and so we want to see what's going to happen, if it's going to hold or not here. So that's Zynga. If we go over to Kong, Kong had that nice little move after they had that announcement, and it has, over the last 5 days, kind of zigzagged, but headed in the up direction. The previous high, which was yesterday, went up a little bit above 940. It's hovering now around 923, between 917 and 923. So that's had the move up, but it's, I'm kind of watching that. But that is in an up direction, so that's good. I am not in that either. And then we were watching Soda, and Soda has had that pullback. We're going into Super Bowl Sunday, and we'll see what kind of announcement they have. They're up 39 cents today, and over the last 6 months, they've still been on a downtrend trying to get through the 40, and they're at 39.08, 39.14 bid and ask. So they're kind of hovering here, nothing earth-shattering going in an up direction yet on Soda. So let's see if Super Bowl moves them again this year.
You know, I'm going to be honest. This whole Super Bowl and the commercials, and it's a big deal, and time and energy and money is spent, you know, having the most clever commercial and all of that. But I assure you that no matter what commercials are shown during the Super Bowl, in no way, shape, fashion, or form is it going to impact what bag of chips I buy the next time I go to the grocery store, or the type of pop soda, you know, if I were going to buy pop.
I totally agree that the commercial, everybody looks at the Super Bowl commercial for its ingeniousness and creativity, but not for what the product is. So, I totally agree with you. However, it does give exposure to companies that are not known. I mean, everybody knows Coke.
Can those companies afford to advertise?
I don't know. They did last year, and they made a huge move last year. So, you know, who knows? Who knows? You know?
Interesting. Second,
the cleverness, yeah.
Second to the Super Bowl in the price per second for a commercial is a little TV show called The Big Bang Theory.
Yep.
About some scientist nerd guys who have the pretty girl lives across the hall, Penny. She's a waitress at the Cheesecake Factory, and all the rest of them are scientists at some university there in California where they live. And I like the show. I laugh
it's
at
a great show.
My wife thinks it's just totally stupid.
I love the show.
Do you really think that's funny? And I go, you know, honey, I do, but not necessarily in a laugh out loud kind of way, even though sometimes I do laugh out loud. But I'm going to be honest, I'm not completely sold on TV advertising. I think for certain things in certain markets, it can do well. We did not make a big deal of this. We kind of kept it under the radar and, you know, undercover. It wasn't really undercover. But back a month or so ago, we had, how many of you know this, but we had commercials on CNBC. I don't know if any of you saw them. The response was okay, tepid. And as I've done more research, people, you know, when you sit there and you're trying to watch a show and you've seen the same commercial, you're watching an hour show, you've seen the same commercial five times.
Right.
Now, the ad professionals and the psychologist and blah, blah, they say that you need, they all have different numbers, but 5 to 7 to 10 calls to action to actually motivate you to do something. Mm-hmm. And so this was just a very small test for us. This was no huge campaign. But one of the things that we learned is that if that type of a thing is going to work for us, then we truly will have to step up to the plate, and we would have to saturate a particular market,
yeah,
like Phoenix or LA or whatever, you know. But the scattergun approach, you know, where, you know, you have a 30-second spot that gets shown, you know, 2, 3, 4 times a day, and each time it's being shown to a different group of people.
Mm-hmm.
You've got the morning crowd, the afternoon crowd, the early evening crowd. I had higher hopes. I'm glad I did it. It was a great experiment.
Yeah.
As our company grows, it's just like David has said, that sometimes people get very depressed because they buy some trading system or methodology or indicator, and it ends up not working for them. Don't count it all a loss, because you've learned something very valuable, that thing
uh-huh.
doesn't work for you. You don't ever have to worry about it again because you've tried it and tested it. Right, David? Is that how you say it?
No, I believe that's the case. I've learned a lot from things that don't work. I actually have.
Sure.
I've really understood, hey, this, in fact, to know something doesn't work is in some ways a very nice way of pushing forward in your trading. You've actually, you know, moved away from the non-usable, non-workable, and that brings you a step closer to the workable.
Mm-hmm.
And I have found that, and everyone in this audience has been through things that they've bought and have been either somewhat satisfied or completely dissatisfied with, and I found that there is something of value. It's like being in a bad relationship with somebody, and you can say, God, that was just a terrible thing, and it was a long time, and but you know what, you learned a lot about what doesn't work.
Yep.
A lot about what doesn't work in your next relationship. You're going to make sure you lay those boundaries down, you know, because that doesn't work for me, honey, you know, or whatever. You've learned what doesn't work, and that starts to push you towards what does. And in fact, in all of the Eastern, much of Eastern philosophy is based on the idea that truth is found in that same way, that by knowing what isn't truth, it propels you towards the truth. Not this, not that, not this, not that. And in the end, you're left with something that is unassailable, and that is the truth. There's a lot to be said for learning about what doesn't work, and your experience with the commercial, and any millions of ways in life these things happen, you know, that you find out it doesn't work.
Here we go, David, from CVS Money Watch. Las Vegas is getting one more novelty. Starting this week, patrons will be able to use the online currency Bitcoin to pay for rooms, food, and drinks at 2 downtown casinos. Doesn't say gambling, does it? The D Casino and the city's oldest casino, the Golden Gate, will accept bitcoins at hotel front desks beginning Wednesday. Cybercurrency will also be accepted at the D's gift shop and 2 restaurants. U.S. dollars will remain the only currency accepted on the gambling floor. Derek Stevens, co-owner of the 2 casinos, says he's been intrigued by Bitcoin for years and has talked with patrons who wondered if the casinos would use it. He said it's tough to forecast how many patrons will pay for dinners and souvenirs with Bitcoin, but predicted that other casinos will soon adopt the currency as well. For us, it's going to be somewhat exciting to see what kind of impact it will have. State regulators are unlikely to allow casinos to exchange chips for bitcoins anytime soon, according to the Gaming Control Board. The industry has not approached regulators about approving the currency for gambling. We would have to have an extremely high level of comfort with virtual currency of this kind for that to ever occur. Made its debut 4 years ago, been gaining momentum ever since. Earlier this month, Overstock.com, friends with the CEO there, Patrick Byrne, a very interesting guy, he became the first major retailer to accept the digital currency as payment for goods. Unlike government-issued money, the value of Bitcoin fluctuates rapidly. Like Overstock, the 2 casinos will use a Bitcoin broker that immediately exchanges the digital coins into dollars. Advocates describe Bitcoin as the foundation of a utopian economy. No borders, no change fees, no closing hours, and no one to tell you what you can and can't do with your money. Now, this morning in the live trading room, one of our partners said that there are currently, including Bitcoin, there's a total of 140 digital currencies available and or under development. And this is where I see the problem. If there were the Bitcoin and the dollar, I think those two could coexist and they could both find their niche. But having 140, I don't know. I think that could be the demise of the whole thing right there. But we'll see. We'll see. The strong,
possibly
the strong survives.
Something like healthcare.
Because it's just, I mean, can you imagine with 140 different cryptocurrencies, I guess they call them, you go in somewhere and they've got to go through this, they got to look up these rates. I don't know. It just seems like, I don't know. Well, we'll just see. We've been following the story now for over a year. We'll keep following it and see what happens. So.
Yeah. Dwayne, I do have to leave today.
Okay,
but normally right around this time. But thank you guys also for the input from the audience. Robin, nice to have you with us today as well. And we'll be back with you tomorrow, and the markets will be a little busier, and we'll have a little bit more to talk about with the markets. So,
two quotes for the day, two quotes. A foolish man works happiness, a foolish man seeks happiness in the distance. The wise grow it under his feet. James mm-hmm. Oppenheimer. Every person has a purpose and a reason for being on earth. Don't worry about what the world wants from you. Worry about what makes you come more alive, because what the world really needs are people who are more alive. Lawrence Lachey.
Mm. All right. Well, thank you very much, Robin.
See you guys tomorrow.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you,
everybody. See you tomorrow.
Bye-bye.
Guys, I'll be around a bit, so... You want to hang tight? Go right ahead.
I didn't notice what time it was. All I know is that I fell in love with you. And if all my dreams come true, I'll be spending time with you.
All right, that is going to just about do it for me. A reminder, you know, Robin is with us 2-3 days out of the week. Plus, she comes on Friday for the Coach's Corner. But you can always visit her at her website, robindane.com. I'm going to go ahead and put that in the chat box for you. www. I'm sure most of you know you don't really need W's anymore, but I'll put them in there for you. Send to all, and I'll put it in the other chat box, which will also turn it into a clickable link. And a lot of great information over there, robindane.com. R-O-B-I-N. Yep, there we go. Okay. No, something's not right. What did I do wrong? No, I didn't. It's R-O-B-Y-N. No, it's... I'm having a cramp, guys. Okay, I know what I did wrong. I've only typed that, a couple hundred times. robindane.com, there you go. All right, I'm going to put the correct website address into the box, and I'll put it in the other box for you as well. Okay, so anyway, Robin will be here this Friday for the Coach's Corner. That's at 3 p.m. Eastern, and then our buddy John Garfield. That we have, I don't know how many episodes we've done of that show, but he's going to be back, not this Friday, but the following Friday, and we'll pick up where we left off. All right, I want to answer any final questions that anybody might have about anything we talked about today. If you have any questions about our free trial, how you take it, what it entails, what does it cover, anything at all. You know what? I forgot to turn on. Oh, boy. And I'm going to have to turn it right back off in a minute. I forgot to put my available light up on the chat box on our website. Guys, we really do monitor the chat box live. In fact, if I'm away from the computer, it comes through on my phone. So I know how sometimes you go to a website and they've got that little box that says, "Ooh, chat with a live operator." And sometimes there really isn't one. You get a couple of canned responses, and then it tells you to come back, call back, email. We actually do monitor ours live. What I try to do, though, is I try to remember to turn out my available light so that it says away, because I don't want people to come to our website and think we're pulling the same old thing where we don't, because we really do monitor it live. And I've been testing my phone again lately, and it's been working pretty well. I was actually driving yesterday, and it went off, and I can't text and drive, so I had to stop, and I responded and said, "I'm away from the office. This is being patched through to my iPhone. I'll get with you as soon as I'm back in the office." So that's one way of reaching us, a much better way of reaching us. That's kind of for new people that don't know anything about us or about our website. For those of you that have been around a while, if you want to get a hold of us during normal business hours, you know, you can call toll-free 866-928-3310. That gets you in touch with Bert and Leslie. If it has anything to do with the platform or getting your indicators enabled and running, if you're on the free trial, They cover all of that stuff. If you want to talk to Michael or myself specifically, 949-42-E-MINI, just like it sounds. 949-42-E-MINI, okay? And there's another number, 415-857-5654. That one just comes to me. But on both mine and Michael's number, 99% of the time, if Michael recognizes your number, he'll pick it up. Typically, mine's going to roll over to voicemail, but it's going to immediately send me an email with a transcript of your message. I will then click the hyperlink in that message, and it will connect me to you right away. So when you call us, if you get a voicemail, please, if you get the voicemail, leave a message, all right, because we will get back to you. We do want to talk to you, especially for those who receive that email over the weekend where I ask how can we better serve you, and then I posted a copy of it, a partial copy of it, last night on the Google Plus page. If you go and read that and you want to participate, you want to get involved in that dialogue, and let me just, for those of you that might have missed it, let me show you here. I think I read this to you guys yesterday. So, you know what? I'll take a second and read it again. I sent an email last night to a few thousand of my closest friends, and the response was fantastic. Some of you here on Google Plus may have managed to avoid my mad marketing machine, and somehow I don't have you on my people to bug today list. That's why you didn't get the email. Don't want you to think it's because I don't still find you fascinating, because I do. All right? So pretend for a moment that you are on the A list and that this is your inbox. The subject line of the email asks a question. Has your hope to become a trader expired? Now, some of you know what I'm talking about. You had high hopes of becoming a trader. You're still interested. You're still fascinated. But you're thinking it's maybe not going to become a reality. According to our records, during the last 3 years, you, and that would be the people I emailed, took our 1 week free trial and decided not to become a partner. It's possible you may have taken the trial more than once because we do offer a second chance of the free trial. If that's you, I would love to speak with you, not to give you some hard sell pitch, but to get a better idea of what you're looking for in the way of trading education. Obviously, you want to trade for a living, and so you at some point decided that in order to do it successfully, you needed some type of education. Well, that's what we offer. We offer education. So help us get a better idea of what you're looking for in your trading education. Our goal is to help each and every trader achieve their full potential. Now, whether you're destined to become a 20 contract trader or a 200 contract trader, we're here to help. There's an infinite loop of miracle solutions out there to the age-old trading dilemma, which is, how do I do it well and do it consistently? It's truly unfortunate that with so many remedies on the market, you'd think at least one of them would work, right? Well, here's the problem. We can never get the right answer by asking the wrong question. The answer lies not out there, but inside of the market and inside of you. Simple solutions that simply work without fanfare or fog machines get lost beneath the glitz and glamour of every trader who ever wanted to own Wall Street. Share with me in an email what currently separates you from realizing your dream to become a trader who trades for a living. In the same email, if you really want a second shot at the free trial, or maybe it's been 6 months and you want to ask for a third free trial, if it's been 6 months, and if you're honest and just straight up with us, send the email, see what happens. All right. Now it says here, space is limited, sales pitch, which we all know that when we get those email, that when it says space is limited, yeah, right. Well, actually, space is limited. We do only have so many virtual seats in our conference rooms. So, yeah, there's a little bit of sales pitch there, but there's some truth in it, too. We do cap out, and we had to increase our size a while back because some of you were not able to get into the daily radio show, and so we had to upgrade, which was a good thing. If you truly think what we offer can help you, I'd like to hear from you. I'd like to hear about it. Again, I assure you, you're not going to get any kind of a hard sales pitch from me. But I would like to spend a little time with you on the phone, picking your brain. I'll let you pick mine. I don't know what people walking by will think when they see these two guys picking each other's brain, but we won't worry about that. Call me on the 415 number, 857-5654. You'll get my voicemail, but if you leave a number, I will call you back. Again, at this stage of our relationship, there's no need for a sales pitch. I'm just curious where you are and also how we can better serve traders just like you who come through our doors every single day. So what I'm asking you is, will you help me? Every trader who calls will be entered to win a brand new E-mini trading computer. And you just might win yourself a brand spanking new E-mini trading computer. I do hope to hear from you. My desk is a little swamped, but if you called or do call, I won't stop until I've called everybody back. I'm pretty sure it will take me through the end of the week to reach out to everybody. And then the ones I miss, and pretty soon we're leaving each other voicemails. I may not end up talking to you until next week. But when you call, if you can say, hey, I'm usually available at this number at this time of day, Eastern, Pacific, whatever time zone you're in, if you really do want to chat, I mean, then call, leave the message, and I'll get back to you, all right? And the computer that you could win, yes, I'm bribing you to participate in the discussion. You can read all about it. In fact, rather than, well, I'll give you the link, but later if you want to find it, just Google E-mini trading computer, and it will be the first result you get from Google. E-mini trading computer, at least it was last time I checked. So I'm going to put that in the chat box right now, in both boxes, including the one that lights it up as a hyperlink. Gary, if you're out there, I am so sorry. I promised you the quote on the i7 chip, and I let you down, man. I told you I'd do it, and I will. But I'm just admitting if you're thinking you missed the email, you did, okay? In fact, I should probably call you and shave a few dollars off for the delay. How about that? Okay. Any other questions? Richard would like to share this. As a member, I can tell anyone who is thinking of becoming a CFRN partner, you truly won't be disappointed, and you will be glad you went down this road. Thank you very much for saying that, Richard. And if I'm not mistaken, Richard has been with us since the official launch, day one. And that, I do believe, was February the 14th, 2011. I think that's right. Thank you very much for those kind words, Richard. I really do appreciate that. And if Richard didn't find value, I mean, he wouldn't be around 3 years later, and he certainly wouldn't be saying that. So, which, you know, brings up another. I'm going to share something else with you. I got this the other day. Let me go see if I can find it real quick. This made me very sad. I've been sitting in as a guest this week and just wanted to email and tell you thank you for the insight. This is from someone who took our free trial last week. I've been trading for a little over 2 years now, and I have to say you guys by far are the best, which, thank you, that's very kind. We don't claim to be the best. We just try to be the most transparent. He goes on to say, I like your approach. Michael's disposition is refreshing. Guys, if you've ever been in some of these trading rooms, sometimes the guru, the moderator, can get a little edgy when the market doesn't go his way, or people start asking, you know, the wrong questions, or start to question his integrity or something. So the fact that this person recognized that and said Michael's disposition is refreshing, that made me feel very good, that it was palpable, visible. In addition to complimenting you on your system, I regret it this time that I'm not able to join due to a lack of funds. Please don't get me wrong. I think the system is worth 10 times what you charge. But I wish I could have found you guys at the beginning of my quest to trade rather than now. I put this up because, trust me, we hear this story more than once a week, okay? I hear from people, man, you know, I love what I see, and I actually downloaded the platform and installed the indicators, and I put on and took off trades, and, huh, you know, but I bought this and I bought that and I bought that and I paid, you know, I went to this thing and did that thing. And man, I am just, we have a couple of options. For those who don't know, there can be a payment option. We work with a couple of major companies that will actually, you know, find, I don't talk about this much because I have mixed emotions. Should you finance a trading education? You know, I don't know if it's a good idea or not. But I do know that if you qualify, you can become a partner and you don't have to make any payments or pay any interest for 6 months. Our course is only 3 months. We have a new version on the way that will embrace the entire 2 years, okay? Remember I talked about the 2 years and the certification and the track record and the hours and the tests and all that stuff. So there'll continue to be the standard 90-day version, but there will also be that additional 2-year package that you can sign up for if you want. If you're already a partner, we kind of grandfather, anytime something new comes along with partners, you always get the indicators. You're just, even if you don't stay active, if you've gone inactive, you still qualify for any of the any new indicators that we come out with and that kind of thing. So if you're already a partner, don't worry. But just know that if you really do want to, and this fellow here, we're working with him to try to, you know, figure out a solution to help him out. And so if you really do want to become a partner, you really do believe it's in your best interest, you've been in the simulator, you've traded it, you've put on and took off trades, and you understand that this isn't some new shiny thing, but that it's something real, that just it works because the market works. Everything we do embraces the underlying rhythm of the market, okay? And so until they break the market, what we do won't be broken, because what we do is simply a reflection of the market itself. That's why we don't have to optimize our indicators. The mathematical formulas that propel them self-adjust with market conditions. We don't have to go in there and wave the old magic wand or change a line of code or anything, because that's how we built it. And so if you want to be a part of the CFRN community, if you've taken the free trial but you know money's standing in the way, then don't be embarrassed by that, all right? Talk to us about it. Let us know your situation, and we'll look at the various options that are available. If you qualify, then it's not even an issue. If you don't qualify, then perhaps there's something else that can be worked out. But you have to initiate that conversation. You have to come and talk to us. You have to let us know where you are, and then it's a case-by-case basis. Once you do become a partner, we have what is called our equity partner program. And basically what that is, it's an opportunity for you to earn back your entire tuition. How do you do that? How do you earn back your entire tuition? Well, trading obviously is one way that you would approach it. The other way is by giving away free trials. Somebody takes the free trial based on your recommendation and they become a partner, okay, we're going to refund $500 of your tuition. Now, once 100% of your tuition has been refunded, do you have to stop there? No, we have some partners that are truly equity partners. They give out a lot of free trials. Okay, it's not like you trying to convince somebody to do something or to hard sell somebody on doing something. When people say, hey, what do you do? You say, hey, this is what I do. And they go, well, how could I learn more? Well, you could take a free trial. Here's the address. Should you decide to become a member or a partner, be sure and let them know I sent you. And that's it. That's all it takes. And every great book ever written about creating wealth, not earning a paycheck, but creating wealth, okay? In every one of those books by all the different men that wrote them, there are many recurring themes. And one of the recurring themes is that in order to create wealth, you must have multiple income streams. Multiple income streams. And so for you, your multiple income stream might be, one, you trade, and two, you give away free trials. Okay. For Michael and I, we trade and we teach. Plus, he has a little real estate, and I have a little real estate. My wife and I are trying to get rid of that real estate. So if you know anybody, no, I'm just kidding. We just don't want to be landlords. One of the condos is gone, by the grace of God. Hopefully, the other one will go here in very short order. So whoever you are, wherever you are, you know, you should figure out that might not be your gig. Okay, being an equity partner. You might want to be a partner, but the equity partner maybe, but you already have something else that you do, something else you're involved in. You have, you know, some side business that you do. Let's face it, on the days where you come in and it only takes you one trade to get your daily goal, you got to do something the rest of those hours. Maybe you're involved in ministry, and so you already have plenty to do. You're not looking for anything to occupy yourself. But that's not going to happen every day, by the way, where you come in and get that daily goal in one trade. Some days it's going to take you two or three or four. You got 10. Every one you don't use today rolls over to tomorrow, and they just keep rolling over, and they never expire. And so when you have that really rough day where it takes you 22 trades, it's okay. You can still walk out of the office with your head held high because you're still on track. You're still on track to graduate the course the end of 2 years as a 20-contract trader. And with that proven track record behind you, and the skill that you have gained over those 2 years, you won't have to worry about work again, okay? All you need is a computer, a solid, fast internet connection. Now, this is the absolute opposite of get rich overnight quick, okay? I'm talking about 2 years. Now, you're like, 2 years? That's insane. Well, maybe it is, maybe it isn't, I don't know. Our course itself is 90 days. We're talking about 2 years is 24 months. So if we take 3 months off the 24, what about those other 21 months? Well, that's you putting into practice everything that you've learned. So as your account balance grows, you mature as a trader, right? You grow together, you and your account size. And when I'm talking about you, I'm talking about your skill set, the level you're operating at psychologically. All of those things develop and grow and mature together. All right, just because we have a 90-day course and a two-year program doesn't mean you're going to be a successful trader. I'm sorry, but that's the brutal truth. Trading is risky. It is not suitable for all people. And you're going, well, why isn't it suitable for all people? Well, maybe you don't have the right temperament. Can that be changed? I think all things are possible. But it's something you'll really have to work at. If you don't have the temperament or the patience or the discipline or all it, see, those are things we can't sell you. You can't beg, borrow, or steal them. You either have it or you don't. If you don't, then you got to go get it. How do I get discipline? How do I get patience? See, that's a personal journey. Okay. Now we'll help you. We'll encourage you. We'll have conversations with you. We'll do private mentoring with you. We can teach you how to read the indicators. We can teach you how to know when it's time to get into a trade, long or short, how to define the entry to the tick, when to exit, all of that stuff. We can teach you that stuff. But those things I just mentioned, nobody can, well, that's a big statement to say that nobody can teach you patience. I probably shouldn't word it that way. People can teach you things, and you can take from what they teach, and over time you can develop patience. You can develop a different temperament. You can develop discipline, right? I mean, when kids go into the military and go into boot camp, most of us have very little discipline. Well, if you've gone through boot camp, you know that they whip you into shape pretty quick, and you develop some discipline. And then some of the guys like it so much, they love that taste of discipline so much that 9 weeks of boot camp or 13 weeks of boot camp is not enough. They want to become a SEAL or a Ranger. And man, you talk about discipline. Whoa. That's a big deal. And so I guess in that respect, maybe you can learn those things. But it's something for you to think about. Because without it, without discipline, without patience, without the proper temperament, you cannot succeed as a trader. I'm confident in saying that. There's very few absolutes in trading. But I am so confident in saying that right there, that without those things, you will not succeed as a trader. All right, let me go to the chat box, wrap this thing up, see if there's any final questions. I think we've covered them all, okay? On this chart, the euro, we have a little bit of a bigger picture trade. It's out on the Google Plus page. We're looking to be long. Actually, the number out on the Google page reflects us being long just above this little swing high right here. Okay. We expect resistance in this area. Why? Because that's where we got resistance before. Am I saying the market can't break through there? No, not at all. I'm just saying there'll be a little bit of a battle, and the market could get rejected. But if it breaks above this high, then I think it has the ability to potentially go at least just shy of that swing high. And if it can get through there, then there, and then there, okay? On the downside. I want to see the market close below this level right here. And again, it's on the Google Plus page. But I know that once we get through this little area represented by the ellipse, you're going to run into support here. It could hold for an hour. It could hold for a day. It could hold for the next decade. I don't know. I just know that if I'm short coming down through here, I gotta take some profits. I gotta cover myself somehow, because this could be the point where the market bounces back up to here. If we get through this area, then the next area that I'll be concerned about, And by concern, I mean if I'm short, I have to protect myself as we approach support. If I'm long, I have to protect myself as we approach resistance. Okay. Okay. Yes, where are we at? Look at there. It gave us the fourth trade. All right, let me walk you through them again. From 39 to 37, once, twice, three times, four times. Price went from 39, the tweet, to 37, the target. One, two, three, four times. So far, it looks like it's trying to do it five. I remember this morning I said the last time I could remember us doing five was crude oil some months ago. Limit one, two, three. Okay, we got four so far. And if this one comes back down, that'll make number five. So I'll leave this chart up for you guys. Let's just move through here real quick. Crude. We got a trade out on crude or a tweet out to consider being short below 93.70. Okay. What kind of target? Well, number one, in crude, it takes 10 ticks to make your $100 per contract per day. 10 ticks. But the place where you could expect to find support would be here, which is like 92.70. 93.70 to 92.70, that's actually, yeah, that's 10.6, okay. You've also got the CFMA1 climbing. And see, it's got the value over here, 92.41. Now, if price starts to drop, this will stop rising and kind of go sideways a little bit. This is a daily chart. Okay. On the beans, we had a tweet to be short 78 to 76 once, twice, three times, and it went and did it a fourth time. But again, just one of those moves, okay, if you're on the two-year plan and you're just looking for the $100 per day, 2 points in the soybeans, 78 to 76, that's equivalent to 2 points in the S&P. Here, one penny pays $50, and the S&P, 1 point pays $50. So these 2 pennies equals $100, okay, per contract. So that was the beans on the Russell. I didn't put anything out last night. Let's go to the daily and see what the week looks like on the Russell. Daily. Okay. Leg. Retrace. Leg. No, that's back. Leg. Retrace. Leg. Shallow retrace. Leg. Let's see where our zones are on the Russell. We have a zone at 1176/77. Again, the zones go out to the partners at the beginning of the week before it goes out 6:15 a.m. Eastern. On any morning that you've not received your weekly zones by 6:30 Eastern, shoot me an email because it got lost somewhere. Okay, lower 76. Okay, 1170. So we're right at a weekly trading zone on the Russell. 76, 77. Okay, what do we have below that? Below that, we have 71.72. That's so tight up in there. You know what? Let me go to an hourly. I think it'll display a little better for you. There we go. Maybe that'll work a little better. And then we can open it like this. There we go. Okay, so we have also on the Russell for the week, we got a zone at 72. All right. Below that, we had 65.66. Okay. So far this week, we've had a zone here on the Russell up to the zone overhead from 66 to 71. That's a 5-point move. We spent 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 hours basically consolidating, bounced. Notice this little double top here. Hey, if we had been watching this market together live in real time, I would have been cautioning you to be concerned about this area. Okay. I could do it like that. I could do it like that. But because it's always an area, okay, think about that. Not necessarily a specific number on the chart. Hang on, let me configure. And I want image only. Drawing tools. I want a rectangle. And I want an ellipse. That's right, I got to take one out. Okay, so there we go. And so rather than just put a line, you can do a little something like that. Okay? Because again, it's an area. So we come back down. Now notice we're mirroring, if you remember, this is just kind of mirroring what happened in the S&P. Back down to this zone. Back up to this zone where we then go through the whole consolidation thing again for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours. Pop up, double top, back down to the zone where we consolidate for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 hours to make a move. We retrace back to the, I haven't done this for a while, so just in case you think the market has stopped, doing that and that and that, it hasn't. It never will, because that's just how the market moves. Leg, retrace, leg, retrace, leg, until eventually it doesn't give you another leg. Well, then what happens? Well, maybe it goes sideways for a bit, and then it reverses and goes the other way. Leg, retrace, leg, retrace, leg, retrace, until you don't get another leg. As soon as you don't get another leg, that's when you go, I need to watch this because it might be turning. We never know how many legs we're going to get. A move could have 3 legs or 5 legs or 10 legs. If we've already got 5 legs in the move, I'm not nearly as excited about taking the next leg as I am the first leg or the second leg, because it's fresh, right? By the time it gets, you know, by the time it hands out five legs, it might be getting a little tired. Need a nap, right? So think about that. So what do we have overhead? That's really the important number on the Russell. On the Russell, we have overhead. After 76, 77, we've only got one more zone. This is it for the week. And that zone is 86.87. So that is truly some wide open spaces right there. See? I mean, once we get above this swing high, which is 79, typically I like to go about 2 points away from the zone. But because we've already had this attempt that, remember, it made the move, retraced, now we're getting a continuation of the move. Why don't we do this? Let's go here. Here. RL M MH 4. Consider being long the Russell above 1180. Or short below. We're embracing both sides of this. Why? Because it's wise to do that in trading. Just because it looks like it's headed to the moon, you know, things happen. So 76, 74 gets me below those tops right there. So yeah, I'm good with that. Or short below 1174, whichever presents first. Russell. People be going, who is Russell? Emini. Ah. Russell. Emini. Futures. Consider being long the Russell E-mini futures above 1180 or short below 1174, whichever presents first. 1 point or 10 ticks equals $100 per contract. So in other words, 1180 to 1181, you're done for the day. 74 to 73, done for the day. And there we go. You and I just sent out a tweet together. All right. Well, we Google plused it. If I get the time or energy or inclination, I'll put it on the tweet or two. But mostly it's for you guys here in the audience. All right. ES, we've already covered that. But we looked at it on a different chart. We looked at it on this chart. Okay. Euro, we already talked about that. Bonds, we already talked about those briefly. The tweet was 131.05 down to the zone. Okay, the zone's 131. Is that right? Hang on. Bonds. 131 to 131.02, yeah. So from 05 to 02, that's only three ticks. But the bonds pay $31.25 per tick, so it's $91 per contract. So you can go three, four. You know, there was room here, I guess, to go the four if you hung in for this candle. And then on this one, so we had it once, twice, three times. But on these, see, if you get triggered in, it didn't make it all the way down, and you got stopped out. This is why I highly, highly, highly suggest that you use all the tools at your disposal. Okay, there's a tweet out, it looks good, you can just boom as the crow flies, or you can bring out the slingshot, line that thing up, see if it will give you a trade. Okay, it might and it might not. For partners in the members area, there's a video specifically that asks the question, can I trade the slingshot ahead of a tweet number? And I spent about 45 minutes discussing the different options available to you, but ultimately you have to make that decision. Okay? My experience has shown me that if the slingshot sets up and triggers right before the tweet number, that has a high probability of working out. Occasionally, they'll line up at the exact same number. And then sometimes it's a little bit late. Those are the ones that you should really, you know, be careful with. Sometimes they work out beautifully as well. Okay? It's just that you now have less room to run. Okay, keep that in mind. And we don't do this market. We could, because the chart's a chart, but we're not gonna do it today. If you guys do have a chart tomorrow that you want me to, you know, kind of dissect a little bit, go through and see if we can pick out some trades, we can do that. Coffee has had a nice move up, leg, retrace. Now, what happens here? Okay. If the uptrend is going to continue, we're going to get a reversal somewhere in here. We're going to go and put in a higher high. Higher high. If this move is over, then what's going to happen, if we measure the last leg of this move, right there, okay, from the swing low to the swing high, we've got a 62% retracement. Everybody see that? Okay. If this gives way, it's 11,497. If this area, if this candle here were to close down on the lows, then I would be potentially very interested in selling the open of the next candle. And then if I'm going to get into that trade, I want to be out of it before we get to this low right here. I mean, is it possible that price will come back to test the actual low? Sure. And it might even break it. Go down, put in some kind of double bottom or something. But what I'm looking for is a high probability setup. And so here's what I see. This number right here. Hang on, I got to move this thing out of my way. Okay. Right here. Okay, we got 11,497. If price can get below 11,400, even if we went 11,350, okay, that's the top of this box, 11,350. If we just traded to the bottom of the box, that would take us from 11,350 to 11,195. whatever that's worth in coffee, I'm not sure because I don't trade the market. But I want to be, if I'm going to get short at the top of this box, I want to be out at the bottom of the box because I got to believe there's buyers sitting here. You know, some of them missed this move. Some of them didn't. Some of them caught this move, took profits. Now they're just sitting here waiting, patiently waiting. As soon as price gets even in this neighborhood, boom, they're in, looking for another move just like this. Okay? In here, out here. No obstacles to the trade. Nothing in your way. No magic, no voodoo. Just simply reading the chart. Okay? Okay. Yes, Jeanette, you're correct. Bonds have gone from 131.50 to 131.02. I think they went, I think we counted three times they made the trip, I believe. I do, Gary, when I have the chance. Sometimes I'm not in front of my computer when they trigger. If I wasn't willing to trade it, I would never recommend it. Ever. I would never suggest you do something that I'm not willing to do myself. In fact, there's lots of things I would do that I would not recommend to you. Ever, ever, ever. So, now, there are things that once you're kind of on my side of the table, you've been around a long time, you know, you could teach the class and all that kind of stuff, you know, then we might be able to talk shop about a thing or two. When somebody's coming in and saying, hey, look, you know, I want to be a trader, and I've struggled, and I've had a hard time, and I've been through this, and I've been through that, I'm going to treat you with kid gloves, man. Just like that trade the other day, that killer long trade, that once it triggered, I wasn't as confident. I redid the math, and I was like, you know, Dwayne, and so I put out a tweet that said, hey, you can get out of this trade right now at break even or better. I'd feel better if you did that. You can do it. It's there. Just go right now, get out, and you'll be fine. And you, I said in the tweet, you might need to sacrifice one tick to get out of the trade. Turns out you didn't have to sacrifice anything because it went on to just be a perfectly fine trade. But when it comes to you, the CFRN audience, the community, the partners, I'm always going to be overly cautious on anything that I tell you. I'm probably going to encourage you to get out of a trade too soon. I'd rather do that and leave a lot on the table than to do it the other way around. So great question, and thank you for asking that, Gary. And Gary, I was just talking about you a few minutes ago. I know I owe you a quote, and gosh, let me get that done today. I feel so bad when I don't live up to my obligations, and I did promise you that. So let me just not say any more and let my actions speak. How about that? Let me get on that. Jeanette, please repeat the coffee opportunity. I missed the numbers. Now, okay, I'll show them to you, but remember, I don't trade coffee. I'm looking at this simply as a chart, as a chart, as a chart. The top of the box is 11,350. I'll write those numbers up here. 11,350. That's the top of that little box there. Okay. Because the low of this candle so far is 11,425. That's the low so far. So 11,350 down to 11,200. No? Yeah. Yeah, 11,200. To 11,200.
so that box may not be perfectly drawn to match up to those numbers, but it's really close. Looks like the top of the box is 11,345, the bottom of the box is 11,178. But from 350 to 200, that's 150 pennies, ticks, whatever it is, and I'm not sure what coffee pays, but I think that's a decent move. And I like the trade. I really do. You know, the first obstacle, what's this swing high? 11,230. You know, if you get into this trade and price starts to work its way down through here, see that little swing high right there? Keep an eye on that. If you get in up at 350 and you make your money, you don't have to try to milk this all the way down. Okay. Oh, hey, you're welcome anytime. My pleasure. Okay, guys, thank you all so very much for tuning in today. Whoever you are, wherever you are, may God continue to richly bless you with His mercy and with His grace. And I'll see you at the bell.
Remember this, there is no greater return on investment than to see a human life changed and given hope. As always, pray hard and trade safe. Any financial information discussed on this show is simply the opinion of our host, Dwayne Reeves, his co-hosts, and guests. To learn more about trading E-mini futures or to take a one-week free trial in our live trading room, call 1-866-928-3310. 866-928-3310. Information discussed on this radio program should not be construed as a recommendation to buy or sell any security. Always do your own due diligence and consult with a licensed securities broker or financial planner before making any investment decision.
Hey you, trader, why the sad face? Bad day in the markets? Bad year in the markets? If you're like many other traders I've met recently, you're about to give up, go broke, or both. They say the definition of insanity is when people continue doing the same thing and expect different results. Sound like you? You've invested a lot of time and money in this trading business, right? Well, before you give up or go broke, let's just take off the crazy hat for a moment, okay? Forget the schemes and scams that litter the internet. That 80% win ratio in his dreams and your nightmares. The 89 consecutive winning trades guy. Liar, liar, pants on fire. It really comes down to what actually works. At the end of the day, who can you really trust on your way to Wall Street? Here's a thought. What if you could spend day after day with seasoned traders and market analysts? What if you could cut through the theory and simply see real-time trades and strategies that work? Debunk the myths and learn the ropes. Cut the risks by avoiding simple mistakes. How much do you think that would be worth in the long run? If you could literally shave years off the learning curve and keep tens of thousands of dollars in your account for the actual purpose of trading, would that be of great value to you? Would that be the definition of doing something different? Right now, CFRN has a limited time offer. I want to invite you to spend a full week with the CFRN team. I want you to test drive our online platform and feel the power of our custom indicators for an entire week. I want you to witness real trades with real money in real time. I want you to see a humble, ethical, and proven trading system that's simple and, more importantly, that works. You can pass this off as just another sales pitch. You can risk tens of thousands of dollars and several years of your life in an attempt to prove me wrong. Or you can come hang out with us for just 1 week. No strings attached, no credit card required. All we require is a simple desire to learn. Stop the insanity today. Test drive our platform and indicators for 1 full week. Trade with us live for 1 full week. No strings attached, no credit card required. If I'm wrong, there'll be plenty of time to give up or go broke next week. So act today. This is a limited time sensitive offer. To get started, visit www.cfrn.net. That's www.cfrn.net. CFRN, a community of believers who trade for a living.
You guys doing? Good. You're awake. I love